Character, culture, and Christ have been the motto for Southern Nazarene University for many, many years. When I came as president, I was really curious about those words and really curious to dig into the archives. In fact, a conversation on campus one day with a visitor to our campus who asked that same question, what does character, culture, and Christ mean today? These days, I like to talk about refining character. I think that we're all in process, and in those collegiate years, those years of a university experience, there's a great opportunity to refine character.
Renew is the University Counseling Center. We are located at 6710 Northwest 43rd Street, just north of the Webster Commons. Renew offers a variety of services, including individual counseling, couples counseling, and psychoeducational workshops. The first 5 sessions for students are free, and students will never pay more than $10 per session. Faculty counseling is just $40 per session. Renew is open Monday through Thursday from 9 a.m. to 8 p.m. and Fridays from 11 a.m. until 6 p.m. For more information, visit renew.snu.edu or email renew@mail.snu.edu.
My favorite things about SNU was the relationships I was able to have with people, with professors, with friends.
One thing that was purposely different about SNU was the integration of faith into the academics. I feel like I learned so much from that helped prepare me for life after college, to be a husband and someday to be a father. It was a really, really transformational time in my life.
My degree could have come from anywhere, but my relationships with people, I know I would not have gotten anywhere else. Go to snu.edu to apply or to schedule a visit.
Well, the wind is blowing in from the northwest down to the south as we get ready for some GAC action at Phelan Field. The Arkansas Monticello Weevils have come to Bethany, Oklahoma. 14-11 overall, 11-4 in conference play is Arkansas Monticello as they get ready to face Southern Nazarene, who just recently had a big upset game against Southern Arkansas out in Magnolia. Here with me, as I'm Grant McNew, I've got Austin Schoenfeld to my left and Riley Roach Smith to my right. Fellas, let me hear from you.
How's it going, everybody? I am Roach, is what they will be calling me on the mic. Just tuning into a little bit of baseball, a little weekend activity, a little pastime of ours, the American pastime, so they say.
Yeah.
Glad to be here. Glad to be joined by two awesome guys. Come on. Yeah, thank you, Grant. Excited to coming off SAU. Big win for SNU baseball coming into a little spring break action, closing us off this week. So excited to be here.
Yeah, closing out spring break, and not to immediately put a damper on your good mood, guys, but it wasn't just the SAU series, which you did end up losing. You got outscored by quite a bit. It was 24-4 in that series, but you do steal a game from the then number 8 team in the country. They've since dropped down to 13. But now you see the Mid-America Christian game, and we talked about this a little bit before the broadcast, Austin Schoenfeld and I did. This was a game that you turned around from a late Monday game that went 11 innings. Then you travel up from Magnolia to Oklahoma City. So that's a huge distance. You drive up, and then you play the very next day at 2 p.m. That's such a quick turnaround. You're playing a quality NCCAA team in the Division I. Losing that game, yes, it's bad, but it's not as bad as what it seems on paper.
Yeah, for sure. It, very unfortunate weather circumstances going into SAU, getting those games pushed back a little bit. But like you said, you're on the road, you're traveling back from a tough series against a very tough opponent, and you have to immediately turn around and play a game in the middle of the week. Not ideal circumstances coming into that game, but luckily we've got a nice home field advantage today, getting to just again close out spring break, hopefully get these guys excited, playing again another great team, another great Arkansas team. So,
and we have a camera operator, Roach. I don't know if you noticed that, but Austin over here on the camera.
Yeah.
Word is he's kind of a professional in that situation. So
sure,
I probably will be talking a lot of this game with a cheek full of seeds, you know.
I can tell, yeah.
But, you know, baseball, that's what it's about.
Baseball, you know? Spring break baseball, you know, there's just so much to talk about here. But let's go into the starting lineup for Southern Nazarene. Leading things off will be Colby Entwistle, followed by Dax Edmonds and Jacob Martinez. Then Trey Orman, the DH, will be cleanup today. We've seen him hit a lot of balls over the fence this season. Then Blake Brinkmeyer, the third baseman, will follow Orman. Then it'll be Hudson, Hicks, and Dias. And bringing up the nine hole will be Tucker LeMay, the shortstop. On the other side of things for Arkansas Monticello, they'll start off with Rock Hawthorne, the DH, followed by Chaz Poppy, the catcher. Then Camden Tanner, the right fielder. Brody Romero, the third baseman. Then Kirk Wolf, an incredible name. Kirk Wolf from left field will bat fifth. Then Cade Cancilla, the first baseman, followed by Aiden Garrett, Chase Cripps, and Will Owens will be the ninth batter in the lineup. So two big lineups coming together here. And again, the wind blowing straight in. Typically, when we see the wind coming into the field, Southern Nazarene struggles a bit more on the bats. Obviously, the wind's not helping you out, but it just seems like the hits themselves don't happen as often, guys.
Yeah, hey. We saw, though, you only need two hits to win a game against SAU. So
That's true.
We get a little bit more than two hits coming in today, but we only need two.
You only need two if you only give up about the same. That's the thing. Because Southern Arkansas, you know, they were incredible for the entire series until that final game that went to extras, and defensively they were still really solid. Really, really solid, but offensively they couldn't get it done against Patrick Hine at all. He came in and just absolutely dealt in a way that we hadn't seen from really anybody all year from any team other than maybe Harding. But today the starting pitcher for SNU is going to be Levi Graham. He's only thrown 10 and two-thirds innings this season so far, giving up 16 hits, 11 earned runs. Does have 10 strikeouts and 12 walks. So he's a guy that he's been a little bit all over, but when he's on, he's on. So you're hoping that he comes out and finds the strike zone early. He's got an ERA of 9.28. Austin Roach, whoever wants to say this, what do you feel about this starting job from Levi Graham, not typically your starter?
Honestly, really looking forward to seeing him out today, you know, even with not having as much expertise behind what a lot of our other lineup has, you know, we still want to see what this kid's got, and I think he's got talent, and that's evident to see from the games that he has played, so obviously looking forward to seeing him throw today.
Yeah, I think
just like you said, Grant, I think coming in and finding that strike zone pretty early is going to be very important for him, especially coming down the nine-inning stretch.
Yeah.
So looking forward to that and seeing what he can throw in his first couple innings.
Yeah, well, and here's the thing, too, is you look at the past games, the most innings he's thrown in a single game has been 3 1/3, so I don't think you see him past 2 to 3 innings. I don't think you're going to try to get him over that hump. If you bring him in for a solid couple of innings, then you can maybe bring in a relief guy after that. That's the start you're looking for. You're looking for a solid start from a guy that isn't supposed to take you the distance.
For sure, but I think you hope you get a couple more innings out of him, especially coming in a doubleheader tomorrow. Hoping that you're not pulling into the bullpen early. So.
Yeah, so we'll absolutely see what he's got packed up in his arsenal as he leads us off today. And, yeah.
Yeah, on the other side of things, it's going to be Connor Irvine, the starting pitcher for UAM. And this is a guy, quite the opposite story. He's been nothing if not consistent. 42 flat innings pitched this season. His most has been back-to-back games with 7 even innings against Harding and Oklahoma Baptist, given those were at home for him. But throughout this season, he's allowed 41 hits, which has been, you know, a pretty high number. Not insanely high. That's a good number, but definitely hittable. But also 46 strikeouts and only 10 walks. So he's been efficient with a 3.43 ERA. 4-0 record as well, I might add.
Yeah, I mean, he's going to be coming out really quick, really strong against our starting lineup. So you're just hoping to just get in his head, read those pitches early, figure out what he's going to, where he's throwing, really quickly.
Yeah, and obviously that gives a leg up kind of for the other team as opposed to Southern Naz. That just shows a little bit of expertise on their side, and that's going to give them the edge going into these first couple innings. But, you know, I feel like we've got a good backing on our side, so we'd like to see that play out.
Yeah, and here's my thoughts on this, guys. You have a very textbook ace coming to the mound for UAM, and Southern Nazarene coming in. I feel like they're trying to dirty up this game a little bit. You want to go in and steal something, especially day one. Tomorrow's the big day. That's the day you're focused on 100%. But here, if you can dirty it up, if you can maybe steal game one, then you're looking to shock the conference.
And now the start is for yours.
Absolutely. Do what you did to SAU coming in on day one of this series, and then turning around and having a doubleheader tomorrow is going to be massive, especially having your big starters coming in for tomorrow. I think that's something that we can look forward to for the rest of the series.
Yeah, 100%. And, you know, of course, you don't want to look ahead to tomorrow by any means. That's obviously not what you're looking to do here. But, again, if you can rest the right arms, because it was a heavy week into Tuesday, a heavy week for your arms where Patrick Hine dealt, Jacob Martinez came in, you saw Gunnar Phillips, you saw all these guys that you usually want to bring in day one. Now you're kind of scrambling a little bit. As you do have the arms, we know that. We know Levi Graham can deal. But you're coming in with a tough situation. You've got to figure something out. And I don't know, you just got to take something here. You just got to take something. Hey, let's take a break. Step away for the playing of the national anthem. We'll be back after this.
Character, culture, and Christ have been the motto for Southern Nazarene University for many, many years. When I came as president, I was really curious about those words and really curious to dig into the archives. In fact, a conversation on campus one day with a visitor to our campus who asked that same question, what does character, culture, and Christ mean today? These days, I like to talk about refining character. I think that we're all in process, and in those collegiate years, those years of a university experience, there's a great opportunity to refine character.
Renew is the University Counseling Center. We are located at 6710 Northwest 43rd Street, just north of the Webster Commons. Renew offers a variety of services, including individual counseling, couples counseling, and psychoeducational workshops. The first 5 sessions for students are free, and students will never pay more than $10 per session. Faculty counseling is just $40 per session. Renew is open Monday through Thursday from 9 a.m. to 8 p.m. and Fridays from 11 a.m. until 6 p.m. For more information, visit renew.snu.edu or email renew@mail.snu.edu.
we welcome you back into the booth, and this is something that we wanted to point out coming into this game, the cloud coverage. That just light gray to deep gray gradient is just right there. That is dangerous for an outfielder, isn't it, Roach?
It is absolutely hard to see those balls whenever they're absolutely soaring through the sky, but, you know, in other circumstances, this would be deemed a perfect day by me. Yeah, but out on the field is an absolutely different beast that you're having to battle against. So we will see how the outfielders today will play against it. But, hey, we got polarized lenses for a reason. We'll see if they make use of them.
Sure.
That is, you know, that's a wonderful point. Not by blue light by any means, but polarized. Never. Nobody really stands up to that, right? Well, starting things off for UAM is going to be Ronk Hawthorne. He comes in a batting average of 385 this season. He has been phenomenal through 52 at-bats. He's got 20 hits, and he's scored 13 times. This guy brings in six doubles. He's only been walked six times. He's a guy that is not likely going to hit it over, only one home run. But he finds his way on base with a lot of consistency. He's a good base runner, a lot of speed on his legs for him. We'll bring in and following him will be Poppy.
The Poppy?
Chaz Poppy.
The David Ortiz Poppy.
That one, yes.
Well, I'm a big fan.
Again, Levi Graham getting the start on the bump for the Crimson Storm. We'll get underway here in the opening game of this three-game series. Graham out of the stretch, start things up. First pitch, that's going to be called ball one. This first at-bat could be big for how long Levi Graham throws in this one. Again, not a guy that usually goes over three innings. So if you can get three out of him, that's what you're happy with. I think that's what they're expecting here with the coaching staff. 1-1 count here against Hawthorne. 1-1 on the way. That one looked good. It was. Strike two. Quite a bit of chatter early from the UAM dugout. 1-2. Delivered. That looked good. It was. Strike three looking. How about that? Early from Levi Graham.
It's exactly what you want to see. Locking in after that first pitch a little low, but coming in with the next three is heating.
Absolutely setting the tone for SNU right here.
Now Chaz Poppy to the plate. First pitch off the mark. Now Levi Graham, first batter, says, you know what? I'm something of an ace myself, and he proves it. Now we'll get 1-1 against Poppy. Poppy batting righty against the right-handed Levi Graham. Now the 1-1 on the way. Swung on. That one hit towards right field. It's high in the air. Dias chasing. Dias, can he get there? No, that ball's gone. Oh, my gosh. It floated. Looked like it was going to reach about the fence. But Chaz Poppy sends it over for the home run, a solo shot for the Weevils. Now 1-0, Arkansas Monticello on the board. How about that from Chaz Poppy?
I mean, that ball carried really close to hitting that foul line, but just snuck through.
Now Camden Tanner, he'll see strike one. One of those pitches for Levi Graham that he just got a hold of. He's throwing strikes here early, though. He 0-1. Now 1-1. One ball, one strike. I'll turn to two balls and a strike. Nice cool day today. Whew, the wave, strike two. Well, it looked like Tanner was looking to go the exact same spot as Poppy with that swing. Pulling towards that right field wall. There, he's going to get strike three. Two Ks now for Levi Graham here in the first inning.
That's what we talked about. That's what you want to see for Levi, just coming out real strong. Ignore that home run, just finish this inning off.
Yeah, obviously, Poppy really got a hold on that one, but, you know, still seeing a strong pitching arsenal coming out from Graham.
A one count. Graham against Romero. Brody will watch strike two. Now an 0-2 count, does Graham attack early here, or just try to catch him reaching? Let's see, the 0-2. He got him, swinging.
There we go.
Four batters face, three strikeouts. You do have the single blip with a solo home run over the right field wall, but other than that, a perfect inning from Levi Graham. Wow.
Yeah, I mean, that's exactly what you want to see from your starting pitcher. Not, maybe not so much the home run, but again, that ball just
it just carried.
The wind. Yeah, right. It caught the wind at the right spot, and I mean, it maybe was half an inch, 2 inches away from the foul line.
You give credit where credit's due.
Yes. Man, 14 pitch inning for Levi Graham. 10 of those were strikes. He threw a total of 4 balls in that inning. That's efficiency, and that's what you need in a game like this, where you're kind of light on arms, guys.
Yeah, find that strike zone early, and he did.
Yeah.
He's getting in the rhythm, so hopefully he can carry us a little bit more through those 3 innings that we were talking about earlier.
And that's exactly what we were talking about, trying to come out strong and lead that first inning with strong pitches and a good selection. Now, I think he did just that.
Hey, let's take a look at the lineup for Southern Nazarene coming in. Colby Entwistle starting things off. Dax Edmonds will follow him, and Jacob Martinez will be batting third. Man, Jacob Martinez has had quite the season this up to this point.
For sure, SMU's player to watch right there.
Trey Orman batting fourth, then Blake Brinkmeyer, Chase Hudson, Weston Hicks, Max Dias, and Tucker LeMay. But let's take a look also at the field for UAM. Connor Irvine on the bump, getting the start, and Poppy behind the plate. Cancia at first, Cripps at second, Romero at third, Garrett over at shortstop, then Wolf, Owens, and Tanner from left to right in the outfield. It's an SMU squad that their last series against SAU didn't score more than 2 runs in any game, and that 2-run game came in the 11th inning is when they got the second run against SAU. They did win that game.
Sure.
We talked about that. They did get the win. So that's what's really important.
Yeah, you're looking for your bats to come alive real early in this game. Like we said, we're hoping not for a 2-hit game, but just finding that rhythm early, figuring out this pitcher quickly so we can get those bats alive.
Well, we'll see what Connor Irvine brings to the table here to start things off for UAM on the defensive side. First pitch off the mark. Will come in for strike one. 1-1 count. Irvine, a junior out of Paragould, Arkansas. Scent whistle will foul that one off to the right side. And there's strike three. Early strikeout for Irvine against Entwistle. Now, Dax Edmonds to the plate.
Number 19, Dax Edmonds.
And Irvine has been pretty phenomenal this season. A 3.89 ERA. Nothing to scoff at by any means. 1-0. Now 2-0 against Edmonds. That one was close. Yeah. breaking ball. That will break in for strike one. Two balls, one strike against Edmonds. Dax working against Irvine. Irvine from the windup. That one swung on, hit high towards the right side. It's going to carry foul. Boy, and just smoked a puddle out there.
Absolutely annihilated.
Now a 2-2 count. Pitch on the way. That one well off. Full count, Dax Edmonds at the plate, batting righty. He's got Jacob Martinez on deck.
There it is.
And there, he's going to take ball four and walk to first. So the first base runner of the day will be Dax Edmonds after the walk.
That's what you like to see. Get that pitch count up a little bit. Still make it onto the base, especially early in this game. Don't need hits when you're just getting walked.
That's a good point. Well, that's just the 11th base on balls given up by Connor Irvine this season. So he'll throw strike one to Martinez. So you can't rely too much on the walks. They're few and far between for Connor. Now an 0-1 count. Pitch on the way. That one inside. Trey Orman on deck for SNU. Martinez working with a 1-1. Pitch comes in. That one off the mark. It broke late. Now the 2-1. First strike two. Caught the corner. The 2-2. Irvine deals. Martinez fouls it off, takes it off the ankle. Painful.
You hate to see it, you really do.
Probably hate to feel it too.
More so, I would argue.
Now the 2-2 again. Martinez got a hold of that one towards right center field. It's going to drop and be scooped up by Owens. He struggled a little bit with it. But that will advance Edmonds to second. Martinez with a single. Now two runners on for the big swinger, Trey Orman.
Exactly what you wanted to see coming out from SMU. Starting the game off strong with the walk and then a deep single. Just get in this pitcher's head.
Yeah, setting the tone. Hey, you might get one swing to float over, but we're going to be consistent on the bats. That's what skipper Grant Ledbetter wanted to bring to the game today. So far, he's happy with it. First pitch of the at-bat, Orman watches it go by for strike one. Another thing about Trey Orman at the plate, he's really selective with what he swings at. He knows what he wants. He does want to hit a bomb.
I mean, who doesn't?
The 0-1. Outside, ball one. Blake Brinkmeyer on deck for SNU. Irvine out of the stretch, the 1-1 with two on. Single out on the board. Pitch comes in, swung on, Orman on the ground. He rolled it over. It's going to be scooped up. Nice play over at shortstop by Garrett to get the out at third. Boy, a snag on the run, showcasing the quickness to get Edmonds out at third.
Yeah, he saved a run right there by reaching for that ball.
Absolutely.
That's a take home.
Snag on the run is not the easiest thing to do, so absolutely good playmaking.
Now Brinkmeyer batting left-handed against the right-handed Irvine. Base hit here. Could score Martinez. We've seen a lot of speed from him on the bases this season. Infield shifted over towards the right. Now the 0-1. Irvine deals. Brinkmeyer, a rocket towards right field. It's going to go foul. Well, that one stays fair. It's scoring at least one. Instead, Brinkmeyer now dealing with an 0-2 count.
Hard to be early when the wind's pushing hard right, too. That ball's just going to carry further right.
Now the 0-2. Irvine. looking to get out unscathed. Pitches in. Brinkmeyer gets a hold of that one towards right center field.
Just might be.
That one's going to be caught easily by Tanner, not even almost to the wall.
Hey, man, I don't wear contacts, so.
Well, there was contact right there. Brinkmeyer got the pitch he was looking for. A couple of them didn't go his way, so SNU unable to get on the board. But they did put a little pressure on Connor Irvine. That's really what you're looking for in the early inning there. This is a nine-inning game. We're going to take a break, step away, and be right back after this. You're watching SNU Baseball on the Call Sports Network.
One of my favorite things about SNU was the relationships I was able to have with people, with professors, with friends.
One thing that was purposely different about SNU was the integration of faith into the academics. I feel like I learned so much from that that helped prepare me for life after college, to be a husband and someday to be a father. It was a really, really transformational time in my life.
My degree could have come from anywhere, but my relationships with people, I know I would not have gotten anywhere else. Go to snu.edu to apply or to schedule a visit.
And we are back. We did do a vision test on Riley Roach Smith. He did fail.
Zero for zero, actually.
Yeah, not good. And then it turned into why he's bad at baseball.
Yeah. I was B team growing up for sure.
Little League B team?
No. That's high school B team. Well, I'm just kidding.
That's called tertiary.
I don't think I played in high school. Actually.
I don't think high schools have B teams. They have there's JV, but I don't think.
Yeah, I did not.
That's usually a freshman sophomore thing.
Correct.
He was the only one on the roster.
Yeah, I didn't play through all.
They made a new team just for you. Well, we've got the first at bat of the inning right here. Well, the music a little late to stop as Wolf is at the plate batting righty. Kirk Wolf, in a very baseball name, at the plate. He's got an 0-1 count. Boy, they'll call it 0-2 now. Levi Graham, he's coming angry.
He's dealing.
He is. No balls, two strikes. Graham from the stretch, loads, delivers. That one swung on over toward shortstop, picked up LeMay, tough throw. Not going to get there in time. So Kirk Wolf able to get a single as he rolled that one over to short.
Tucker LeMay making a great catch there, but not able to wheel it in and send it to first in time.
I can see ya to the plate. Cade batting righty as well with a runner on first. He'll see strike one. Yeah, credit here to Graham as well, by the way. Sure, you've got a couple pieces of contact made, but he's throwing strikes.
Absolute heat down the middle on that last throw.
Runner's going to go. That throw looks like it's there in time. No.
Just barely going to make it safe to second base.
He got around the tag. That was good base running by Wolf to get away from it. The throw was on the money from Entwistle. Now 1-1 count. Runner on second. Swung on. Fouled off to the right side.
Hey, Roach, where'd you park?
Hopefully not. No, we're close. We're safe.
Okay.
Unless somebody hits a dinger that goes straight back, I think we're all right.
Well, I don't think that would be a home run.
Dinger that goes straight back.
1-2. Graham sends it in. That one swung on. It's going to get through on the right side. On the ground. Scooped up by Dias. Wolf headed home. Wolf going to get there easily. Sliding in head first. So UA Monticello now with two runs on the board off the RBI single from Cancia.
Yeah, just finding the gap in between first and second right there. Neither player's moving, but I don't think that ball was gettable. So.
Now Garrett at the plate. He'll check for the first strike. Not the pitch he was looking for early in the count. 0-1 now. Still no outs. Runner on first. We'll see if they send Cancia to second. That one going to be dribbled right over to Edmonds. That one scooped up. Pitch. LeMay decides to hold on to it. A chance for the double play, but they will hold on probably wisely. It looked like Garrett was there in plenty of time. So they'll get the leadoff runner out. Hey, you'll take an out on the board and hold a runner at first any day. Now Cripps.
Yeah, it looks like Graham is fishing for that double play ball. Got two opportunities for it. Tucker being wise, not throwing that second ball, though.
Now the 0-1. That's one of those, hey, live to play another day. That's what I was taught in Pee Wee football, by the way. Hey, sometimes you have to run out of bounds. Sure. They had to teach me that because I was 4'2", probably 70 pounds. 1-1.
Which is good if you're in first grade.
Well, I wasn't.
We're on the B team of baseball.
That was fifth grade. Maybe even sixth. When does Pee Wee football stop? I think it's sixth grade.
Fifth grade?
No, because, no, I remember. Seventh grade is when you started off
middle
with school. Yes. Yeah, so
middle school football, correct.
Sixth grade.
Yeah.
That was the peak of my athletic career. The 1-1. Breaking ball. That went off the mark. 2-1.
Then they learned that they could just use your voice and commentate the games. You didn't even need to be on the field.
Fun fact, the high school football coach tried to get me to quit so that I would play football. And I looked at myself and I said, why do you want that? You don't. 2-1. As did the track coach, actually. I would have won a ring if I had done that, but I didn't. I said, I'm not running.
I can see you throw a javelin.
You don't do that in high school.
No. Sure.
Really?
Texas high
really?
School, you do.
Texas, maybe. I'm not from Texas.
Bologna.
Arkansas.
Minnesota.
Minnesota. 3-1. You like that? You like that, Roach?
That was fun.
Three balls, one strike. Graham sends it in. That's going to be strike two. A full count now in front of us. Cripps at the plate. And he's the eighth batter of the lineup. Owens is on deck, the nine-hole batter.
Yeah, I feel like you could have been a runner, man.
I probably could have been. I'm so fast.
Yeah.
That's what they say. They see me run around campus and say, wow.
Flash Thompson.
That's what they called me in high school.
Quick-witted.
I used to be on track. Can you believe that?
No. A 3-2. One out on the board. Payoff pitch on the way. Graham loads, delivers. Runner goes. That's going to be ball four.
That was a big battle.
That was. Strong at bat from Cripps. So with Chase now on first following the walk, Garrett will stand on second, and Will Owens will come back. We'll get a meeting at the mound. All right, Roach, I need your lip reading skills. Tell me what they're saying.
Well, it looks like they're talking about the new hit movies that are hitting theaters right now, which is Dune 2 is all the talk of the town. So
okay.
It really looks like they're discussing the plot line and if it's really been more relevant to pop culture. And it seems they agree on the matter and they're just going to leave it at that. And yeah, and we're going to take it up.
That's wonderful insight by you.
Yeah.
Incredible. I don't know how you do it.
Honestly, you know, I've been really working on my lip reading past couple months, knowing I was going to be taking this one shift in broadcast booth. So.
Oh, man. Now the first pitch of this at-bat will be hit high towards left field. It's going to float out of play and count a strike one.
Just killed a groundhog.
Just, man. You hate to see it. Pre-game, there were horses out in the field. They're gone now. At least I don't see them.
The storm's coming.
It's true.
Storm's brewing.
It's more ways than one.
The storm's in front of us, actually, yeah.
And they are brewing.
Bruins? Boston?
I was waiting for that, actually. I knew it was coming. The 1-1. Levi Graham. From the stretch, Graham loads, deals. Oh, just off. 2-1 count.
dugouts live. You can hear them.
You can. They're right there. Two balls, one strike. Pitch on the way. That one will bounce. 3-1 count. Gabriel Sanchez warming up for SNU in the bullpen. Sanchez, a junior. Boy, in the 3-1, that's going to be called ball four. Looked like Owens thought it was strike two, but that will load the bases. So a duck's on the pond. You're going to bring up your leadoff batter, Hawthorne, and Rock struck out looking his last time up.
Yeah,
one out.
Much different inning than the first inning from Graham.
Hawthorne will get a hold of that one. It's going to be in foul territory. Can the catch be made along the wall? No. It looked like it might have rolled out of the glove of Brinkmeyer over the fence. I don't know if it did that or if he couldn't reach it. There is a dugout in the way. So.
Well, you might know if I move the camera.
That's the 0-1 on the way. Now 1-1. And if you're Graham and you battle back in this one, then you're feeling really good through the rest of the games. That one's just on the ground. A rocket towards first. Man, and the decision there from Hicks was to touch first and hold on to it. I don't know if it looked like Entwistle wasn't ready at home or if it was purely a void, a big mistake thing.
Yeah, I don't know if Hicks was able to scoop that ball up as smoothly as he wanted to, getting that ball out of his glove.
It just looked to me like he could still make a play there. But with that, you get the out at first. You do allow another run, so it's 3-0 Weevils. With runners on second and third. First is your only force with Poppy at the plate. Now a 2-0 count. Pitch on the way, swung on, fouled off right side.
That might be in truck territory, actually.
The Deeger straight back.
The Deeger straight back.
One of the rarest calls in baseball.
You'll only hear it here, folks.
Is that a good thing? The 2-1 on the way, that one tipped.
Levi battling back there, huge.
Yeah, if you get out of this only allowing two runs in the inning and one out of that situation, you're feeling pretty good.
Yeah.
The way you batted last inning, you feel like you could put some runs on the board yourself here at Phelan. Another foul ball. Boy, Poppy doesn't want to go away. Last time up, again, he poked one over the fence. In a solo shot. And you feel a little funny saying he poked one over, but that's really what it seemed like.
Yeah, it was not crushed, that's for sure.
Now the 2-2. Graham. He deals. Off the mark. So Poppy has worked himself to a full count with two runners on, two outs on the board, and Graham out of the stretch. Payoff pitch. Swung on. That ball is crushed, but it's too high to get out, and the catch is made by Hudson. Well, he got more of that one, it seems like, than the one that went over. The wind blowing the wrong direction for him that time. You only allow two runs in the inning that time if you're the Storm, so you feel decent about that, guys. But other than that, what did you think?
Yeah, Levi coming out after that solid first inning performance, but he got to battle out of that one a little bit. And again, we talked about it pregame. He's a three-inning pitcher, so getting three innings out of him is probably huge for the Storm coming into the rest of this game and the rest of the series. So I think we're looking for one more inning from him.
Yeah, if you can get another solid inning out of him, you've got Gabriel Sanchez warming up in the bullpen. So you give him another full inning to warm up, man, you're feeling great.
Oh, yeah.
You're feeling wonderful.
And 39 pitches so far from Graham. That first inning, obviously keeping that number a lot lower than he was probably expecting to go for three innings, which looked really good. But panning out on the average, it looks like he's going to get about three, and that's what we're hoping for.
And like you said, Grant, you feel good if you're the Storm. That first inning looks really good for you. Bat on balls, getting people on base. So coming in the second inning, you're looking to do the same. And honestly, put some runs on the board. I would feel really good about that.
So. Yeah. Well, it's going to be Hudson, Hicks, and Dias, the next three up for the Crimson Storm, as they will get ready to come in and face Irvine. Boy, and Hudson was ready to step up, and the umpire had to push him back. He thought it was time to go. It was not his time yet. Now it is.
Poppy had to practice his pickoff right there.
Chase Hudson to the plate. He'll bat left-handed against the righty. Irvine from the windup. He brings in strike one. They'll on the way for strike two. No balls, two strikes. Irvine ready to go right back to it. Where does he go with this pitch? The 0-2. That one tipped right back to Connor. He'll scoop it up easily. Routine play for the out at first.
Didn't look like he realized he made contact with that ball.
No. So Hudson couldn't reach. He'll be followed by Weston Hicks. Now 1-0 count early. 1-0. What a dirty breaking ball right there. And that'll come in for 1-1. What a pitch. Connor Irvine. 1-1. That one on the ground towards short. High hop picked up easily by Garrett. And a laser over to first for out number two.
Making contact with the ball. Weak contact, but making contact, figuring out how Irvine's pitching is huge, but needs some of those bigger hits that we had in that first inning.
Now Max Dias at the plate. That pitch is high for ball one. So far, this is the inning that we expected to see in the first from Irvine. A guy that deals, and that ball bounced. Did it hit the umpire face mask, or did it hit Poppy's face mask?
I'm going to say ump. I put money on ump.
So I'm going to go with a hit Poppy. Just based on your vision tests before.
It hurts. But it's likely true.
The 2-0. Irvine delivers. Boy, they'll give him ball three on that. Wow. Max Dias with a 3-0 count.
Could just be the break that the Storm need in this inning.
Well, two-out hitting has been solid for SMU this season. That's been where they've gotten a lot of their runs. You got Tucker LeMay, the 9-hole batter, on deck. And it was on the hole as Dias hits that one high towards left center field. Tracking is Owens. Owens is able to make the squeeze for out number three, so that will get us out of the second inning. And that's another one of those, you've got typical win, that ball is likely gone.
Absolutely. I mean, he got solid contact with that ball, but like you were saying, that's the inning we kind of expected from that first inning from their starting pitcher, so.
And Roach is dancing in the booth.
You can't see it, but know I'm doing it in your heart.
What does that mean?
It means just know that I'm having a good time. I don't know.
Well, so far, SNU down 3-0. They've given up three hits and only gotten one of their own up to this point. It's going to be Gabriel Sanchez making the appearance on the mound here in the third. So Levi Graham's day is done. He did complete that second inning. In a solid way, you got really what you needed out of him there. As Sanchez comes in with a 7.8 ERA. Through 15 innings pitched, he's allowed 26 hits, 13 earned runs. He's only walked 7 batters and he struck out 16, allowing a batting average of 3.56. So a guy that can come in and shove.
Absolutely, and you're hoping to get a little bit more than two innings out of Gabriel, keep that bullpen light. So,
yeah, I'm 6 appearances, 15 innings. What's the average there? What does that come out to? Quick math. Come on,
Austin Schoenfeld. Whoa.
I got to be honest. Hearing the numbers that were being said right then.
Doesn't matter when all he's going to do is come in and strike these guys out. So.
Yeah, well, the last 3 appearances for Sanchez, it was at Oklahoma Panhandle State, here against East Central, and then at Southern Arkansas. So we went 3 innings, 3 innings, and 4 innings against those 3 in that order. So you could see a 4-inning game here out of Gabriel Sanchez. It seems that he's only gotten better as the season has gone along.
That's what you're looking for. 4 innings would be huge for him. Put us in the 6, but starting us off strong right here is a big first step.
He's going to face Camden Tanner, the 3rd batter of the lineup. And he'll start off with a ball inside towards the knees. The bee's knees. I knew I'd get at least the noise out of you for that one, Roach.
You can always count on me.
1-1 count. Gabriel Sanchez. That one hit hard towards left field. It's in foul territory. It's going to be out of play. Falls in the bullpen of Southern Nazarene. 1-2.
2 groundhogs lost.
But who's counting? Who's counting?
Groundhogs in your truck.
1-2. That one on the ground. LeMay. He's going to grab it. The throw to first is in time for out number 1. Tucker LeMay. Solid play defensively. 1 out on the board. Brody Romero to the plate.
Let's go, Brody!
Boy, kind of a quiet day from both dugouts so far today. And what a pitch from Sanchez. Beautiful, beautiful ball. 0-1 count. Now 1-1.
One of the weevils just barked.
I don't think bugs do that. 1-1. Now 2-1. You know, catfish kind of bark. You'd think they'd meow, but they don't.
Did not know that.
2-1. So do squirrels. That one on the ground. Brinkmeyer, he's going to cut it off, make the throw to first. And boy, what a stretch from Hicks over at first to get the out.
Routine play.
All right, chat. I just looked up what a weevil is because I had actually.
You didn't
never
know what a weevil
one.
Was.
No.
It's a bug.
Yeah.
It eats cotton.
Yeah, I didn't know.
Only Arkansas honest. Things.
That is, it is, yeah, there you go.
This thing. I mean. Yeah, I mean, I'm looking at this thing. That thing is a weevil.
I didn't have on my bingo card that Roach would be dumbfounded that bugs exist. The 1-0.
Just weevil isn't a bug name, you know.
Beetle? What are you talking about?
Beetle's a bug name.
It sounds worm? Like beetle. What?
No. Weevil sounds like a varmint more so.
What are you? You mean like weasel?
Yeah.
Ooh, wow.
Man, that's a dirty pitch for strike 1. Roach, I'm lost.
Look at this thing.
Yeah, I see it.
It's a great photo. It's HD.
The 2-1, man, another dirty pitch. They'll give him ball 3 on that. Broke just a little late.
3-1 count, Sanchez still throwing heat. Open.
Now a 4 balls on that at bat. It was 4-1, which will bring Wolf to the plate following the walk.
Andre the Giant. I mean, he's so tall.
Yeah, I'm thinking hopefully every strike zone pitch just might be out of his reach, so fingers crossed here.
Excuse me, that's Cancia. Wolf is who just walked. Now 1-0 count. Sanchez checks first. Now Roach has me like all over the place right now. I don't really know what's going on.
The roster says he's 6'3". I don't believe it.
What? What are we talking about?
The batter.
He's 6'5".
He's a giant.
At least. You know. That bat looks like a toothpick in his hands.
Now, 2-0. This is... Okay. All right.
Yeah. I mean, that is a weevil.
Now the 2-0. Sanchez on the stretch. He'll send it home. That one swung on towards center field. And underneath it, making the catch is Martinez. Easy grab for him. That's three outs. The first scoreless offensive inning for UAM as SNU looks to get their bats ready. We'll take a break, step away, and be right back after this. You're watching Southern Nazarene Baseball on the Call Sports Network.
Character, culture, and Christ have been the motto for Southern Nazarene University for many, many years. When I came as president, I was really curious about those words and really curious to dig into the archives. In fact, a conversation on campus one day with a visitor to our campus who asked that same question, what does character, culture, and Christ mean today? These days, I like to talk about refining character. I think that we're all in process, and in those collegiate years, those years of a university experience, there's a great opportunity to refine character.
Renew is the University Counseling Center. We are located at 6710 Northwest 43rd Street, just north of the Webster Commons. Renew offers a variety of services, including individual counseling, couples counseling, and psychoeducational workshops. The first 5 sessions for students are free, and students will never pay more than $10 per session. Faculty counseling is just $40 per session. Renew is open Monday through Thursday from 9 a.m. to 8 p.m., and Fridays from 11 a.m. until 6 p.m. For more information.
Well, we bring you back early from that break. Someone may have been distracted, so they didn't get to the second, commercial in time. But that's okay. We're back in action. Tuckler Mays at the plate. Still Connor Irvine on the bump. He's going to go quickly with the first pitch. Breaking ball looked good. It was for strike one.
You just said it, Grant. He has a very quick pitching cadence.
He does. The one on the way. The wave. He got a piece of it, but that's good enough for strike two. 0-2. Man, if I'm Irvine, I'm going right back to the strike zone.
Absolutely.
Here.
Absolutely straight down the middle. We'll see what he does.
0-2. That's what he does. That one going to be hit on the ground. It's going to get through. LeMay looking ahead to second. He'll put on the brakes and get right back to first as that ball shot under the glove of Garrett. The ball thrown to first is off. And LeMay will advance to second, and they're going to send him to third. The dead ball will send LeMay to third.
That's about as hopeful as you can be for a play like that.
Oh, my goodness.
A leadoff triple.
Yeah, what should have been a single becomes a mistake that lets him run to second, and then the dead ball sends him to third.
Come on.
You've got your leadoff batter, number one in the lineup, Colby Entwistle at the plate. What do you even credit him with there? They'll give him a single, but he advances to third.
Sure. It was the speed that got him there.
That is...
Oh, we're having...
Not many people have the ability to get a single and make their way to third in the same play. You know?
Confusing to us, confusing to their coach as well, who's having a big discussion with the umpire.
John Harvey just trying to get some clarification. I think he got what he was looking for, recognized that he wasn't going to get what he was looking for. As Colby Entwistle has gotten to listen to his walk-up song longer than he ever has in his entire career.
And I say keep it going as he starts
swinging. Keep going. First pitch to Entwistle. He's going to let it go by. It's going to get by Poppy. Tucker LeMay standing at home will be the first member of the Crimson Storm to strike today. They give him an awkward advance to third, and he takes advantage. And it's 3-1 with Entwistle still at the plate and a 1-0 count.
That's the way to do it. One swing, one hit, and make your way home without hitting it again. Absolutely brilliant right there.
Yeah, what an interesting, just all-around sequence for Tucker to just get home with.
Man.
Really.
Oh. Now Entwistle skies that one to the right side. That's going to be out of play easily. 2-1.
I think Zeus has that ball now.
Yeah, 2-1. Entwistle again, same spot.
What about that
2-2.
One, Roach?
He might have slipped up on that one. He wasn't ready for the second.
He wasn't looking. That broke him. That broke. Okay, 2-2. Entwistle will see ball three go by. Man, and you know, that might have been the most Tucker LeMay way to score.
Absolutely.
I can't get over that. Full count, payoff pitch, Irvine deals. That one, boy, a hack that keeps Entwistle alive. Looked like it broke away. It was low and outside, but he gets a piece of it. Full count. Now payoff pitch off the mark, ball four. Entwistle walks to first. Now Dax Edmonds will come to the plate in what has just already been a bit of an awkward bottom half of the third. He'll see ball one.
Man, honestly, if you're Irvine, I think you're rattled a little bit. You're not really sure what's gone on this inning. Now you've got one run scored on you and one runner on first.
Edmonds hits that one hard to center field. Should be caught, and yep. It is by Owens.
He's about to talk too soon without about having no outs on the board. But, you know, even with one, I feel like SMU has a good position here having their first point on the board. But now with the one out, allows a little comeback.
So they're runs, not points.
Sure.
just making you aware. Jacob Martinez at the plate. First pitch to him. He wanted all of it. He's going to get strike one.
And honestly, I would not want anybody else batting right now. Talk about momentum. Jacob can bring it here.
Martinez on the ground. That's going to get through to right field. When for a moment, it looked like he was going to head to third. He'll hold up at second wisely. But a single for Martinez has runners on first and second with Trey Orman to the plate, and he's thinking one thing and one thing only, yard.
This is exactly what you want to see coming into this third inning, especially against a good pitcher like this. Just get under him a little bit, starting to read his pitches a lot more, but bats on balls.
Irvine. On the stretch, good pitch, strike one. Now the 0-1. We've got a young pitcher in the crowd. The 0-1 from Irvine. He looks second, now we'll send it home. Orman leaves that one alone for ball one.
I think Little Ledbetter out there would have thrown a strike right there.
Hey, put him on the mound. Let's see it. Now the 1-1. On the way, Orman. Got it off the end of his bat. I'll go foul for 1-2. One ball, two strikes, a single out on the board. Runners on first and second. Connor Irvine looking to get the second out of the inning. The 1-2. On the way. Orman towards left field. Is that one going to get down? No, a tough grab by Wolf. He had a drop onto his chest as that ball looked like it just died in front of him. For a second, you thought Orman was going to steal a base hit. Instead, he's going to be out number two. And now Blake Brinkmeyer to the plate.
Looks great coming off the bat. I thought that might drop in a little bit, but... unlucky, great play.
You know, I might jinx this here, but I'm feeling good about this one.
Oh, no.
I'm feeling good about this at-bat.
Brinkmeyer takes ball one.
Just going to say it now. He's going to be gone.
He's gone. Okay, Roach is calling for a home run from Blake Brinkmeyer. Okay, the 1-0. Irvine taking his time. Now Brinkmeyer will watch strike one. And in case you were wondering, Blake Brinkmeyer has yet to hit a home run in his collegiate career.
This is it.
1-1 count.
Please go deep.
Yeah. Well, he's going to foul it off his ankle.
You know what they say, why not? Why not today?
Yeah. Why not today?
Russell Westbrook.
It's just, I don't, the freshman third baseman, I don't think hitting home runs is really what he goes for. He's been a solid contact hitter. He's got a 312 average. If you'd
at least splitting.
The 1-2, Brinkmeyer hits that one high towards center field. That one is going to be caught by Owens.
It would have been.
Hey, I'll say this. Maybe in Roach's eyes, that's gone.
Hey,
he can't see that far, so.
He can't.
To him, that's gone.
I would have understood if you're like, oh, here comes an RBI double.
Sure.
No. See, that's where you guys' realism, it hurts the gameplay. And honestly, I'm just trying to be a little more hopeful.
And it's not even a shot at Blake Brinkmeyer. That's just not how he swings.
You never know. You know, sometimes people surprise you.
Hey, I will say this. Weird inning, but a good inning for
yeah.
SMU.
Hey, you now are matching UAM in hits. They do have an error on the board for them, and you're down two runs heading into the fourth. Honestly, this is a top team in the GAC you're facing. You just stole a game from SAU. And this is your light pitching game against UAM. If you keep things going, now I'm not saying anything crazy.
Sure.
But if you're hanging around right now, boy, there's a lot of season left.
Yeah, and you feel good about going into tomorrow's doubleheader.
Yeah.
Looking forward to that with the huge pitching staff we've got lined up for tomorrow.
How about this pitching staff today, though? They've been solid.
It has.
Levi Graham, Gabriel Sanchez, they've stepped up in a big way.
Really impressive. And you're looking for a good inning coming from Gabriel right here. He's dialed in now, figuring it out. You just hope that he is able to lock in for the rest of this inning.
Well, we're going to see Garrett come to the plate. He's going to be followed by Cripps and Owens at 7-8-9.
He's playing for the wrong team.
Three strikes and 16 pitches. Come on.
Austin, I don't know what you're saying.
What a cool name, though. Crimson.
No.
Oh.
What? Austin, what are you saying?
I thought you said Crimson.
This is Aiden Garrett.
Sure.
He saw strike one. You're talking about Chase Cripps.
Sure. Crimson for short.
That would be for long. The 0-1 from Sanchez. Oh, man, he won it. And I don't know how you don't swing at that. It was a wonderful decision to hold on. But that ball had all kinds of stuff on it. Now the 1-1. The wave for strike two.
He didn't hold on to that one. He tried.
Now the 1-2. Sanchez against Garrett. Garrett got a hold of that one towards right field. Dias under it, and Max Dias makes the grab. One out now. Now we'll see Chase Cripps.
Or Crimson.
No. No. We are renaming people's children today. That ball, fouled to the right side. Roach is losing his mind.
Belongs to Zeus there.
No.
Fun fact, Chase Cripps does have a twin brother also that plays for the Weevils.
Also a name Chase.
Cripps.
Oh, sorry.
No.
Would have been a lot cooler.
Gosh. Sanchez deals. Boy, there's going to be strike two. 0-2 count. One out on the board, no runners. Abe Sanchez.
He
0-2, swung on that one, bounced to Brinkmeyer. Brinkmeyer going to have to send a laser. He does for out number two. Well, he's been really good over at third base this season. Again, just a freshman that stepped in this year, and he has earned his spot in the infield.
It's going to be fun to watch him for the next couple years.
Oh, for sure. I can't wait. Now Owens. Will Owens sees strike one. Sanchez brought in that one. On the ground will go foul to the right side. Looked like for a moment Hicks was going to be able to grab it. But it shoots foul. So an 0-2 count now against Will Owens. Looking to avoid the three up, three down as he battles. No balls, two strikes. Sanchez looking to get out of this one quickly. There's ball one high. Trying to get that elevated fastball, it looks like. Now the 1-2. Breaking ball. Now 2-2. Owens just outside.
It was close.
Looked like it was going to be well high by the time it broke in. A lot of movement. The 2-2 swung on that one towards left field. Is it going to drop in fair territory? No. It'll go foul. So Will Owens still alive here on the top of the fourth. Two outs, no runners. Two's hot on the board. Pitches in, that one hit high to the right side. Don't say it, that's gonna go foul.
Making Gabriel work for this third out here.
The 2-2. Sanchez loads, deals. That one on the ground, Hicks. He's got it for out number three, a three batters faced inning for Gabe Sanchez. Boy, what is happening?
Hey, that's exactly what you want to see coming out from Gabriel. Get the batters back in the box after that solid second inning from us. And solid third inning, really.
Well, here's the thing, even just that at bat, Austin, that at bat alone screamed, okay, he's going to get on base somehow. But Gabe Sanchez doesn't stray away from just the strikes. And it goes his way.
And yeah, even when they're not strikes, they're really good. I mean, that breaking ball was.
He's just throwing junk.
It's awesome.
That's what it is.
But
throwing two innings for only 22 total pitches and no scores. I mean, runs. It's just, that's the kind of thing that we like to look for, especially coming out, breaking open.
Yeah. Well, and, man, you're only down two if you're the Crimson Storm. Given next inning, you have to face the top of the Weevils lineup. But coming in now, you're down two. And you're going to see Hudson, Hicks, and Dias, three guys with heavy bats, that if they just find the ball, good things happen.
That's what you're hoping for from these guys. Again, you've got the momentum right now, so just holding on to that and trying to put some runs on the board while you have it. That is what we are hoping for.
Hey, while we have a second, though, we do have a picture that we wanted to show you guys. This is a weevil. Now, this itself is a rice weevil, not a boll weevil that UAM is technically. That's who they are. But for context, those are grains of rice that this bug is on.
Yeah.
That's
look,
a weevil.
Look how small that sucker is.
Tiny.
Now that's a weevil.
That's a cool thing, though. That's cool. I'm sorry. I'm a big fan of you've got a school team name that nobody else really has. That's
sure.
Awesome.
Sure.
Who thinks of that? A genius. That's who.
Or a lunatic.
1-0. Swung on. Hudson towards the left side. Does that ball get down? That ball does.
It does.
In left field, Hudson. He'll take a single. A hot single in Chase Hudson's area will bring Hicks to the plate.
I
like I said, keep those bats hot. That's what you're looking for to start this inning.
Irvine, first pitch off the mark. Yeah, here's the thing. If you can hold on to this game with Connor Irvine, the ace, on the mound, you're doing something right.
Yeah,
2-0.
They've got a lot of trust in him. They've got no one in the bullpen, so.
Well, they're expecting him to go 6-7 at least. And they're holding true to that. Given he still had a really good game on the bump.
For sure. Storm is just being able to read those pitches well.
Yeah.
And early. Feels good.
Now the 3-0. Irvine deals. He'll give him strike one.
And hopefully Irvine playing out a few more innings gives the Storm a chance to kind of get comfortable with his pitching style and hopefully rope a few more out.
3-1. Will bounce for ball four. No danger of Hudson heading to third. He'll be content with standing at second. But now you got runners on first and second. No outs. And Max Diaz at the plate. We'll get a meeting at the mound. May see some movement in the UAM bullpen shortly. This is interesting, though. This is Austin, and I don't want to presume anything too outrageous here, but this right here, given you're still down two runs, this right here feels like what SNU baseball expected themselves to look like this season. From before the year started.
Absolutely, and you've got 20 more games coming into the rest of the season, so you've got a chance to turn the season around and make it a pretty decent looking season. And especially, I think your game plan coming into this game, get on the board early, get in the pitcher's head early, and I truly think that we're doing that. And it's showing right here, especially coming in his last two innings, that we've got the momentum, we've got to keep these bats alive, got to keep putting ball in play, and hopefully get some more runs on the board. And you steal this game, who knows what tomorrow looks like.
Absolutely. And you talk about maybe the record for UAM being 14-11, and we didn't really touch on this too much because it's kind of common knowledge around the GAC right now, but that one is going to be a laid-down foul. But the pre-conference schedule for UAM was very tough. Very, very tough. Four of their losses came to UCO, who has been ranked for the majority of this season. They've got another ranked loss as well as that. Bunt from Dias will go foul as well.
Hey, UCO ranked 25 right now.
They lose by four to Missouri Southern, who was then number 23 in the country. And they've got a couple losses in conference. Two of them coming to Wichita Baptist, another very strong team. But one of those games they lost 1-0. They've been right there in almost all of their losses. They lost to Harding 8-4, but they won that series against the Bisons. They beat OBU. They didn't sweep them, but they beat them 2-3. This is a very good Monticello team. Absolutely. Very, very good.
Having four losses in the GAC only is huge. So the ability to be able to steal this game today, not getting ahead of ourselves here, but I mean that's an awesome opportunity for the Storm.
Oh, that's 1-2 count. I thought that was strike three. I'm sorry, but I thought that was strike three. Nia stays alive. 1-2 count. We'll see if he can take advantage of this. Irvine loads, deals. Dias holds on to ball two.
Couple balls in the dirt from Irvine the last couple pitches. I mean, you got to be feeling good seeing those. He's also, fun fact, changed his pitching cadence a little bit.
He has. Now the 2-2. Connor Irvine sends it in. Dias sees it go high for ball three. Three straight balls now from Irvine.
I'm someone who loves consistency, so the fact that he's changed his pitching cadence is just wild to me.
Payoff pitch on the way. No outs on the board. Runners on first and second. Irvine loads, deals. Hacked foul to the right side, and that was one. It was just a stay alive swing, but you're exactly right. That ball got launched to the right side. Now Dias, still alive. Full count. Irvine from the stretch. Payoff pitch on the way. And again, Dia stays alive. Boy, it bounced out of the glove that time of Poppy. And Dias still in the box. Full count again. We'll see another payoff pitch. Irvine, off the mark, ball four. Max Dias earned it, and he'll load the bases. No outs, bases loaded. Off of two straight walks from Connor Irvine, one of the stronger pitchers in the Great American.
This is who I want to see at bat right now. After his last at bat, just a solid hit.
Tucker LeMay wants to lay it down. He does, down the first baseline. It's going to dribble foul. Boy, if that stays fair, LeMay might have beat that out.
Really, that's almost a perfect bunt from him.
An 0-1 count. Now does the infield shift in? You feel like they were already coming in with bases loaded and no outs. The corners have been brought in. The 0-1 out of the windup. Irvine brings it in. LeMay watches it for strike two. Here's the thing. Tucker LeMay, the nine-hole batter, he's been, whenever he does find contact, he's been good, especially on the base running. But you've also got Entwistle on deck. The 0-2, Irvine. He wants his first out, won't get it. That one just off.
Yeah, knowing you got the top of the lineup coming in here, it's got to just feel so good for the Storm.
One ball, two strikes. Connor Irvine deals. LeMay stays alive.
Truck territory right there. That's a dangerous foul.
Dinger straight back.
Dinger straight back. Jeez. LeMay still fighting. At this point, too, the pitch count becomes a factor for Irvine. Now the 1-2 again. Connor brings it in. That's a beautiful pitch. Oh, my goodness. Talk about a breaking ball. He gets him looking.
There's nothing much you can do there if you're Tucker. You're not expecting that ball to come through after a couple of heaters.
No.
Irvine.
That's just the first out of the bottom of the four. Now Colby Entwistle at the plate. This is his third at-bat of the day. His last time up, he got walked. I should say third time at the plate. There's ball one. He struck out back in the first, looking. Base hit scores at least one. That one going to be launched by Entwistle to right field. Tracking it is Tanner. Tanner has no hope. Grand slam. Woo-hoo. Colby Entwistle. Are you serious? Colby Entwistle with no regard. That ball's flying with the Angels now. Goodbye. Man.
Man, that's exactly like that first home run we saw at the start of this game, just sneaking by the foul line.
That one hit hard to right field. Dax Edmonds gonna get down and bounce off the wall. You thought that one might sneak over as well. It does not. Edmonds will get a double. Dax Edmonds immediately puts another runner on. It's 5-3 Storm over the Weevils here in the bottom of the fourth. A runner on second, and Jacob Martinez, who's got two singles, comes to bat. One out on the board.
This is exactly the inning you wanted to see coming off that last inning from the Storm.
You felt like something was starting to shift for the Storm the past few innings with their offensive turns. Here you're starting to see a little bit of it come to fruition.
Some call that the storm's brewing.
Stop. Get out of here.
Come on.
The horses are back, by the way, Austin.
All right. That's, oh.
Speaking of storms.
Shout out SNU Equestrian.
Yo, one. How about Equestrian? They're good.
They are good.
Martinez sees ball one.
And even though we were talking about the cadence being switched up by the pitcher, this is exactly what we were looking for going into these innings, starting to get a little bit of a grasp on his pitching style, and it looks like SNU is just getting by just fine.
Yeah, and it's got to feel good if you're Ledbetter looking over and seeing that they've already got someone in the bullpen. It's inning four. I mean, you're relying on their pitcher to pitch six to seven innings.
Yeah.
So inning four already got someone in the bullpen for the other team. You just got to feel good the rest of the series.
The 2-1 on the way. Martinez is going to dribble that back. It's going to die in front of Irvine. He does make the throw, but he thought it was going to roll a little harder than it did. That was danger for the Weevils. They survived that. Two outs now, runner on third. And you mentioned the action in the bullpen. That is actually Ruben Macias, who's got a 6.19 ERA this season. He's thrown 16 flat innings. 16 hits, 11 earned runs, 13 strikeouts, and only 3 walks, by the way. Another heavy strike thrower. When Trey Orman.
Just reached a little bit there. Hey, he really wanted to get contact on that one, but not quite.
I think he got some golf in this weekend or whenever they got back, Wednesday.
Not to bring this up again, but Irvine changing his pitching stance again back to what it was.
Here's the thing, though. It feels like it's not even his rhythm that's getting thrown off. He's just trying to throw off the batters. And, yeah, we saw the grand slam. We saw a couple walks. But in terms of hits, it's worked okay.
Yeah. Coming into this game, having as many strikeouts as he's had, probably just not getting what he's wanting here. The batters just aren't chasing him. Great, great ups for SNU.
Yeah. Now 3-1 count. Two outs on the board. Orman batting righty. Runner on third. A base hit scores again. 3-1 on the way. Orman on the ground hard to third. Scooped up by Romero. The throw in plenty of time to finally get the Weevils out of the fourth. They'll get ready for the fifth inning. And offensively, they need to get something. They're down two to the Crimson Storm, who just shocked the GAC by stealing a game from SAU, who was the number 8 team in the country.
Hey, looking to do it again.
Man. Hey, while we have a moment, we do want to bring some attention to one of SNU's very own. This is Augustine Seaver, a member of the SNU soccer team in Austin. He lives actually in your dorm. He's a guy that got diagnosed with leukemia really recently.
Yeah.
Honestly, caught a lot of people by surprise, caught him by surprise, and his family was not expecting that diagnosis at all. But this is a GoFundMe to help his family find travel and housings. They are from Japan, so they are actually in town trying to pay for housing, trying to pay for travel and medical costs. So if anybody at home wants to donate, you can scan that QR code. You can go to GoFund.me/867FF736. That's if the QR code doesn't work. We just wanted to throw that out there just in case anybody wanted to help out the cause.
Absolutely. He's a very positive presence in Snowbarger dorm and to that soccer team. Very good soccer team. He's a very good player. So
we'll get back underway here.
Great first pitch by Gabriel. I mean,
was not a noise I was ready to hear.
Brought it right at the corner.
The 1-0 now.
Didn't get the call, though.
That ball skied and foul.
And it looks like one's going to belong to Zeus.
Also truck territory.
Also truck territory.
Oh, man. 1-1 count. This is Hawthorne, by the way. Rock, the first batter of the lineup. He'll be followed by Poppy. Now 1-2 count.
Did you say his name is Rock?
Yeah, Rock Hawthorne, R-O-C.
Reaching our city.
It's kind of awesome.
Reaching our city. That's, yes. Another just great cause.
Yeah.
2-2. Rock will get a hold of that one. It's going to drop in left center field. Martinez will hold him at first. Solid piece of hitting that time from Hawthorne to get the single.
Yeah, just over Tucker's head, not able to jump and reach that ball.
Maybe if he was a good 13 inches taller.
Sure. I can't get over how cool that name is.
He's pretty tall right now.
Well, yeah, so Roach is still caught up on Rock.
Rock.
As Chaz Poppy is at the plate, batting righty. That one hit high towards shallow center field. Martinez, is he going to get it? Yeah, he will.
Juice gives that one right back to center field. Easy out for the Storm.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. An employee of Southern Nazarene University, everybody.
I read Percy Jackson. It was a good story.
It was a very good series. That was like late elementary into early middle school, though. Yeah, that was. I think I read that in the third grade.
Yeah,
maybe the third.
No way.
Dude, I was a fast reader.
That's fifth grade material.
Actually, here's the thing. Here, I'll tell this in a second. That one is rocketed. Man, oh! Hicks with a beautiful grab. Can he get the double? No, he can't. A little trouble on the throw to second, but he'll get the out. Oh, my goodness. What a play from Weston Hicks. And heads up to get the lead runner.
Big snag there. Saving a maybe double, potential triple.
Two outs on the board. With Romero to the plate. But yeah, while I was learning to read as like a little kid, instead of learning to read first, I memorized a book. I made my mom read it every single night until I memorized it. So I tricked my parents into thinking I could read far before I could.
That's kind of awesome.
I think they were thinking, why does he only read one book? That's all I memorized.
What was the book?
I don't remember.
No.
It's
been unmemorized. It was a Good Night Moon?
Whew. I don't think it was good. I hated Good Night Moon.
Really?
As a kid, I thought it was creepy. I don't know why I did. I hated it.
I can kind of see that.
2-1.
I just like the pictures.
Well, moons don't talk.
That's true.
The 2-1.
It was a kid talking to them.
Bruno Mars.
Yes. Hey, speaking of Bruno Mars.
3 balls, 1 strike.
Gabriel Sanchez has been absolutely dealing.
Yeah, that has nothing to do with Bruno Mars. 3 balls, 1 strike, 2 outs, pitch on the way. They're going to give him ball 4 just outside.
Sanchez is pitching that 24-karat gold out here today.
That was good. That was good.
Well, except he just walked a bat.
Well, okay.
So that was an interesting time.
It was overall, good at bat at least.
Looks good on paper.
Kirk Wolf at the plate. He'll take ball 1 up high.
No, but coming in thinking that you're maybe only getting 3 from Gabriel. His first 2 innings have been solid coming into a third inning with a quick 2 outs. Kind of losing track of it a little bit here, but able to just hopefully bring it in and get that third out and get out of this inning going into this fourth.
Yeah, if you can get out of this inning without allowing a run, then you're feeling outstanding heading into the bottom of the fifth. And there's strike 1. That was the pitch you needed in that situation. Now the 2-1 on the way, swung on. That one hit high towards center field. Should be routine if it's not lost in the clouds. Martinez got it.
I think he was dancing out there, but.
That's what it looked like. Maybe nervous for a second, but that will be the third out. We're headed to the bottom of the fifth. SNU up 5-3 against the Weevils out of Arkansas Monticello. A very rural town, by the way, if you didn't put that together from Weevils.
Never been. Because it's probably a small town because Weevils is pretty small. So
that is
big correlation there.
Wow. Yeah. That is – oh, my. I don't know what to say about that.
I play and I watch some Sherlock. I mess around.
You mess around. Interesting. Hey, let's take a break. Step away. We'll be right back after this.
favorite things about SNU was the relationships I was able to have with people, with professors, with friends.
One thing that was purposely different about SNU was the integration of faith into the academics. I feel like I learned so much from that helped prepare me for life after college, to be a husband and someday to be a father. It was a really, really transformational time in my life.
My degree could have come from anywhere, but my relationships with people, I know I would not have gotten anywhere else. Go to snu.edu to apply or to schedule a visit.
And we are back and ready for the bottom of the fifth. Again, SNU leading this one by two. It's 5-3. Southern Nazarene, a strong spot here in game one of this three-game series. It's Trey Orman, Brinkmeyer, and Hudson. The next few up, it should actually be Brinkmeyer, Hudson, Hicks.
Looks like we got a new pitcher for UAM out there. Good for SNU. Hopefully keeping those bats alive. Six hit game so far coming into the bottom of the fifth is massive. That is exactly what you're looking for to try to steal this game out.
Yeah, well, you know, you bring in Ruben Macias if you're UAM. He's got a 6.19 ERA. This is a guy that still has been pretty efficient this season. But when you just were really getting used to the tough pitching of Irvine, bringing a guy like this in who's probably not going to have the same kind of, not quite a quick pitch, but not the same sort of cadence. Interesting to see how SNU deals with the change here. Straight out of the stretch, too. First pitch, called strike one.
Setting the tone right there. He really brought that one in.
I really like the strike call of this home plate umpire. It looks like the Foghorn Leghorn, come and get you some. The 0-1. There's ball one. I was hoping he called again just to see it. 1-1.
I'll zoom in next time.
Yes, yes. One ball, one strike. There it is, see? 1-2 now. It's right there. Usually you get like the point with the number of strikes, you know? No, not him. 1-2. I'm okay with it. Pitch on the way. That one swung on. Brinkmeyer hops it over to shortstop. It's going to be scooped, and the throw is on the money from Garrett to Cancia. That'll be out number one. So the ground out from Brinkmeyer brings Chase Hudson to the plate. Hudson was the leadoff batter last inning. He hit a single. He'll take ball one. A 1-0 on the way. Boy, ball two. Hudson hits it hard to the left side. That's going to be in foul territory. Is it out of play? Yeah. And a sliding attempt on the gravel.
Yeah, kind of strange that he decided to slide there and the ball fully.
Well, it might have been I don't want to run into the wall kind of thing, maybe.
I mean, sure.
Hey, do what you got to do. Do what you got to do. You're standing out there in left field. You haven't had a ton of action.
That's fair. We do have a warning track on the sides for a reason, though.
Yes. 2-1. Macias to Hudson. Hudson gets a piece of that one. It's on the ground towards first. Easy play for Cancia. He does it himself. Two outs now. Now it'll be Weston Hicks, who got walked his last time up. He also grounded out to shortstop back in the second. Hicks, high to the right side, foul ball. A 1 count. Ruben, Now Macias on the stretch, sends it in. Hicks towards right field. That ball should be caught by Tanner. It is on the run as he was drifting. He makes the grab for out number three. With that, we're headed to the sixth inning. And this is a nine-inning game. It's the only one today. We'll have the doubleheader tomorrow. And this first game is oh so important for both sides.
Absolutely. Again, SMU steals this game. That's a back-to-back steal from big teams for SMU. Truly, potentially changing the rest of the season for these guys.
Yeah, well, and sorry to cut you off, but at some point, if you do, quote-unquote, steal this game, does it become, instead of stealing, just a straight-up, you're outplaying?
You're so right, and I think we're gonna get to witness that. Depending on what we do for the rest of these 20 games, we're going to probably look back at this series and we might change that. We might not have stole that game. We might have just played to our potential and realized that we're a good baseball team.
Well, and it's the thing, too, and, man, preseason there was a lot of hype around this team of, okay, no, you're not the best team in conference. Let's throw that out the window. But you feel like you've got arms that you haven't had before. Your hitting is definitely solid, maybe not quite DJ Van Atten or EJ sure. Taylor. But you've got guys that are swinging the bat well. And then the season came and it just fell apart.
I'm sure tough injuries to start the season, so I'm sure that mentally yeah. affected them a little bit. But I think now that we're rolling and now we're deep in the season, we're feeling it. We're realizing we are a good baseball team. And we're out here proving it right here. Proved it this last weekend.
Old Cancia's at the plate. 2-0 count now for him. The sun has popped out.
Yeah, those clouds are gone. Quickly.
Well, that was very quick. 2-0 looked good. It was. For strike one. Now 2-1, foul tip. Two balls, two strikes. Two on the way. That one swung on well towards right field. Dias, well, he stumbled on his cut back towards the wall. That's going to allow the ball to reach the wall and be good enough for a stand-up double from Cancia to lead things off here in the top of the sixth.
Yeah, read the off-the-bat ball just a little wrong. Was able to recover a little bit, but then took that stumble and it just went right over his glove.
Yeah, off the bat it looked like just a line drive that he wasn't going to have to move for, but I think the backspin carried it more than he thought it would. And now Garrett coming to the plate with a runner on second and no outs against Sanchez.
It's a big thing with Oklahoma. You have that wind. That wind does a lot of things to a ball. And we've watched it all game here. With every ball going into the right field, it's just, you just can't read it.
Zach Robinson warming up for SMU in the bullpen. That's a guy that you see pretty often come in towards the late stages of games, and he's been solid all season. That's a strong arm to have on your side.
And truly, you've got what you wanted out of Gabriel Sanchez.
If not more.
Absolutely.
And the same thing to be said about Levi Graham, too.
Mm-hmm.
The 0-2. And here's what's crazy, too. These aren't guys that start games for you usually in conference play, at least not game one.
Yeah.
But you found something, it seems like. You found something here. So that ball is ripped towards the dugout of the Weevils. Remains an 0-2 count. And again, it's not a knock on these guys either. You got just such a deep pitching crew this year. But they've stepped in and they've proved that they deserve a spot here.
Absolutely. And Grant, that when I look at this team preseason, that's what I'm looking at. How deep our pitching crew goes, and that's what I was most excited to see. And truly being up in the booth today, just being able to witness what this is. And like, you got deep guys that are coming in starting for you that are really doing good and getting exactly what you want, if not more, and putting it to a very, very good baseball team.
1-2 count. Against Garrett. He's got a runner on second, no outs. Again, the Weevils trailing by two. They feel like this could be the inning they tie things up at least with a runner in scoring position already and no outs. Sanchez, that one's well off the mark, got away from him a little bit. 2-2 count, good job by Entwistle to make the grab though, hold the runner a second. Boy, what a luxury too to have good catchers too, behind the plate. Another foul ball.
Yeah, ones that have really had to step up this year after Carson going down, and they've stepped up in big ways.
When that Kennard injury, it hurts bad. He is, I think, feeling better now. But you felt like he was going to have an all-GAC type of season. Then all of a sudden, he's gone. You've responded well, though. You've responded well. 3-2 count. Garrett has forced a full count as he's continued to battle here against Sanchez. He's got that, like, tieback headband, too. That's awesome. Payoff pitch from Sanchez. Loads, deals. Look good. Did he go? He did not. They'll give him ball four. Looked like Sanchez just missed on the inside. I'll put runners on first and second. Now, that's obviously not what you wanted, but you do now have a force out at second as well. So keep that in mind as Cripps is at the plate. Cripps grounded out to second his last time up. Comes back in the fourth. First pitch, he wants to lay it down, and he does. Good bunt. Sanchez going to scoop it, send it to first. Got it. That'll advance runners, but you do get the first out of the inning. A little small ball from the Weevils. One out now on the board. Will Owens to the plate. And Grant Ledbetter feels comfortable now bringing in Robinson. This is going to be it for Sanchez. And this is, I think, an ovation-worthy performance from Gabe Sanchez.
Absolutely. Did his job to perfection. And while he was on the mound, the Storm took the lead. So just got to feel good walking off the mound right there.
Hey, three innings in relief, zero runs allowed total. Not earned runs, zero total runs allowed from Gabe Sanchez. That is exactly what you wanted to see out of him. And now you've got Zach Robinson coming to the mound, a guy that has dealt for you in a lot of situations, a lot of tough situations. We'll take a break, step away, let him get warmed up, and come back after this. You're watching SNU Baseball on the Call Sports Network.
Character, culture, and Christ have been the motto for Southern Nazarene University for many, many years. When I came as president, I was really curious about those words and really curious to dig into the archives. In fact, a conversation on campus one day with a visitor to our campus who asked that same question, what does character, culture, and Christ mean today? These days, I like to talk about refining character. I think that we're all in process, and in those collegiate years, those years of a university experience, there's a great opportunity to refine character.
Welcome you back. Zach Robinson on the mound now for SNU. A 5.82 ERA from him. He's allowed 18 hits and 11 earned runs through 17 innings pitched. He's has 17 strikeouts and 13 walks, so a guy that can do a lot of different things. You feel good, though, about bringing him into this situation and out on the board. Runners on second and third. These are the kinds of spots you've been putting him in all season long. Hopefully you can get out of this one as he's facing the nine-hole batter of Owens. And there's strike one to start things off. Rock Hawthorne is on deck. He's at the top of the lineup for the Weevils. The one outside looked like for a second. And Will Owens wanted to chase it. He lays off. It's 1-1. One ball, one strike. Robinson against Owens. That'll be ball two. Now the 2-1. On the stretch. Hit high, that one. Gets to center field. It's in the left field. It scoots over. It's very shallow. Underneath it is LeMay from a shortstop position. That is an ideal piece of contact for Zach Robinson.
Yeah, that probably is best case scenario. Sounded like it was going to the moon coming off his bat, but staying in the infield is huge there, not being able to have a sack fly and getting.
Yeah. Hawthorne now at the plate. Batting lefty again. Runners on second and third. Two outs. Base hit likely ties the game here in the top of the sixth. And there's strike one. Roach has made his return. He had to go fix a water leak.
And consider it fixed.
The 0-1. That went way further than I wanted it to.
Yeah, that one's on me.
1-1.
I don't know why I keep getting asked to do these kinds of things.
There we are.
Robinson sends that one outside. He's trying to get the sweep across the plate. He didn't get it that time. Just working the outside edge. That's what Robinson has done all season long, is look for the outside third. Couldn't get it right there. 2-1. On again, outside, ball three. Three balls, one strike. Two outs, runners on second and third. Top of the lineup at the plate in Rock Hawthorne. Big situation, big spot for both sides. UAM feels like they need something here. 3-1, that's gonna be ball four. And the bases are loaded.
Here's the thing with that. Yes, it hurts having another runner on. You just got to really trust in Robinson. Now you got to force out any plate. That feels good. You got one out left.
Well, here's a little more bad news. Oh. You got Chaz Poppy at the plate, the sure. only Weevil to hit a home run today.
Sure. Roach called a big Poppy to start this game.
He did, and he meant it. First pitch from Robinson to Poppy will be called strike one. And you get out of this one, though, as Robinson, and you've got a lot of momentum headed to the offensive side as you're looking at 8-9-1 coming to the plate. The 0-1. Robinson brings it in the wave, strike two. 0-2 count against Chaz Poppy. Two outs, bases juiced. Zach Robinson. From the stretch, loads, deals, swung on, right side will go foul. That ball to the moon will drop.
On a car.
I thought it hit a car, actually.
I think it
for
might
second.
Have.
Remains 0-2.
It's
Poppy, still alive.
Don't some would argue it, but same Zeus's territory up there.
Gosh. The 0-2. Robinson. Got
yes.
him! Swinging! Wow!
I mean, that is why you bring him in opportunities like that. He's not unfamiliar territory for him, and he came in and delivered exactly what he needed to do.
Bases loaded, and Zach Robinson gets the strikeout that SNU needed as UAM could not find it. That was Chaz Poppy at the plate, a guy that is found the ball in every at-bat in some capacity. He's flown out twice, but he's also got that home run. That's the first strikeout of his day. And Zach Robinson, he couldn't do it at a better time.
No, just blew that ball right by him. It was...
Man, bottom of the sixth coming up. And for SNU, you got Diaz, LeMay, and Entwistle coming up. Guys, if you can put a little more on here, some insurance heading into the seventh.
Yeah, it's going to feel great trying to finish out this game. You get one runner on, and you've got the top of the lineup coming up. And again, the second inning facing this pitcher, you just got to start feeling it at some point. And I think SNU is ready. They're ready to take this lead and just go big.
And here's another piece. You feel like there's something here that you haven't had in a long time. And Austin, that thing is hope.
You're absolutely right, Grant. And truly, I think that SAU win did a lot more than just give us a one win in the win column.
Oh, 100%.
I think these guys are now believing that they really can do this.
Yeah.
And that's huge.
Kevin, there's still a lot of game to be played here, but the fact that through six, you're up two against Arkansas Monticello, that in and of itself is big.
And one of Arkansas Monticello's big-name pitchers.
Oh, yeah.
Game.
Dude, Connor Irvine, who's incredible. Now facing Ruben Macias. We get strike one. 1-1 count. One-one to Dias. Pitch on the way. Dias sends a rocket up the middle on the ground. He'll stand up on first, and for a moment, you felt like Macias was about to have to get carried off the field.
Yeah, that was an absolute laser beam right back at the pitcher.
Whew. So Max Dias gets a leadoff single to bring Tucker LeMay to the plate. And Colby Entwistle is on deck. LeMay, he'll take ball one, acting like he wants to throw down a bunt. He may look down the first base line for this one if he does end up laying it down. His third base has crept up almost even with the mound. Yeah, he's going to pop that one up foul.
For a bunt, that ball got sent.
One-one count. No outs on the board. Runner on first. LeMay lays off it. 2-1. The 2-1. Macias brings in three balls now. One strike. Tucker LeMay in a favorable position in this at-bat. The 3-1. Macias off the mark, ball four. So 8 and 9 both reach, and one comes to the plate.
Yeah, I think Ruben just realized that he's trying to, his hands are probably really sweaty out there, and he's trying to rub his hands on the turf. Didn't work for him, so he had to go grab the chalk bag. And already getting a mound visit in the bullpen.
Yeah, the bullpen, a little action out there. Just the beginning stages of getting warmed up. But Poppy wants to have a conversation with Macias, I should say. He also brought in Cancia. That may be one of those, hey, let's focus up. Just get this batter. This is Colby Entwistle at the plate, a heavy hitter. He's got a grand slam already today.
I mean, yeah, zero outs. Top of the lineup about to just run up. And you've got speed on the baseline right now.
And the sun has shown up here. First pitch they have bat. Entwistle pulled away. Woo.
Looked like it hit him.
I think they're going to say it hit the bat.
They're going to go
for 0-1.
All right. Well.
Now, that play surprises me a little bit, having Entwistle throw one down. I get it.
Cole.
I'm not anti letting Colby Entwistle do anything, honestly. That time he's going to send it off the chest of Romero. No throw to be made by Garrett as he scooped it up, so the error at third loads the bases.
I don't know if that was meaningful, but the fake bunt.
Yeah.
To bring up the third baseman, and honestly, really, what's caused the error there?
I don't know about fake bunt. Well, it seemed like a failed bunt.
That's so fair.
But to your point, I don't think you see him creep up like that. And if he's back where he's standing right now,
that's a routine double play.
It's a routine double play. But bases loaded, no outs, and Dax Edmonds at the plate. First pitch to Edmonds. Edmonds is going to rail that one to the right side. Foul ball.
Landed in the street.
0-1 count. Macias to Edmonds. 0-1 swung on that one towards center field. Is it going to get down? Doesn't look like it will. But with that, Dias will score. Max Dias off the sacrifice from Edmonds.
Love to see a good RBI like that.
Now one out on the board. SMU doubling up on UA Monticello. It's 6-3. Runners on first and second. Jacob Martinez at the plate. Ball one. Now the 1-0. Macias off the mark. Ball two.
Yeah, Jacob has got pitches to work with now. Really looking for what he wants here.
And allowing Martinez pitches to work with is dangerous. A 2-0 on the way. 3-0. That one well off as Nathan McManus is the man warming up for UAM. Left-handed pitcher. He's a 6-foot junior standing about 210 out of Yorba Linda, California. McManus. It's a good last name. Brandon McManus. Franco legend. 3-0.
Absolutely.
Off the mark. Ooh, ball four. Wow. Four ball walk.
Far.
Will send
outside.
Martinez to first. That is, yeah, exactly.
Wow. Yeah, all four of those balls that Ruben just threw right in the top of the strike zone. I don't know what he wanted Jacob to hit.
We're going
to
get a meeting. Here's what's interesting. Here's what's interesting. If this is it, which I think it is, this is going to be it. You've got Nathan McManus, who hasn't gotten to warm up very long. Bases loaded, one out. Who's at the plate? Tell me, Austin. I'll tell you, actually. It's Trey Orman.
You know what they call him?
What do they call him?
I don't know. I was hoping you would
know. I don't know. They usually call him Trey, actually.
Sure.
So base is loaded. One out. Trey Orman, the heavy hitter, a guy that usually gets one a game.
Now's a good time to get one. We've already had one grand slam this game.
Who was that LSU pitcher back in the day that lied to his coach, said that he used to hit bombs? You know who I'm talking about? What was his name? Oh, no.
That's actually such a deep one. That's funny.
You bring in a new face to the mound. It's a coach, he's scared. They are scared.
Here's the thing. Trey Orman doesn't lie when he says he hits bombs.
He doesn't. Because we've seen it. Here's what's also interesting about the situation, okay? The stats for Nathan McManus either are wrong,
sure,
or they're insane because it's only zeros. However,
okay.
Technically, according to this, he has two appearances coming in back-to-back days against Colorado School of Mines and Missouri Southern, in which he threw zero innings, allowed zero hits, zero runs, zero walks, zero strikeouts.
What a performance.
So we have no clue what is at the mound in front of us. This is baseball. This is baseball.
Complete unknown territory here.
What we do know, okay, he's a junior standing 6 foot, 210. What else is crazy is he's listed as a left-handed pitcher. but he just is throwing with his right hand. No, here's the thing. Here's the thing. Actually, I think I do know what's going on. I do know what's going on. This is Dylan Vail. We were told about this, Austin, and we forgot.
We did forget this a little number change.
Dylan Vail. Oh my goodness, that changes so much. That changes.
Yeah, we were warned that this would happen.
Oh my gosh.
We did not remember.
He is still a junior. He's 6'2", 195, also from California.
He throws right-handed though.
He does throw right-handed. That's the difference. That is a key difference. 1-0 count. Here's he's working against Orman, the 1-0. Ball on the way, Orman. Man, an awkward swing. He'll go 1-1. So we do have actual pitching statistics.
That's good.
For Vail.
Not straight.
Man, a 6.87 ERA, which is solid coming in as a reliever. 18 and a third innings pitched, allowing 14 hits and 14 earned runs. He's got 10 walks and 12 strikeouts. Dylan Vail will have that one swung on by Orman. Man, in some trouble, fielding it over at third, and the throw to first, off the mark, one plated for the Storm, and they'll hold up with Orman at second, and Martinez on third. So let's break down what just happened there, okay? What looked like it was going to be double play ended up being one out, getting the runner at third. One does score, so now it's 7-3 SNU. Only two outs on the board. Runners on second and third off the error on the throw as well.
Yeah, that's back-to-back errors from that third baseman right there. Just getting balls riding up on him and hitting a little bump, or I don't know if he's not playing it right, but, man, that's huge for SNU, taking this momentum even deeper, putting up seven on the board.
Yeah, and Brinkmeyer.
Deuce.
It had been a while since we'd heard from Roach, and there it is.
He still is here.
Sorry, I was shopping online.
Of course you were. Brinkmeyer with two strikes to his name. I believe it's a 1-2 count. Runners on second and third. Southern Nazarene leading by four here in the bottom of the sixth. Looks like it's an 0-2 count, rather. No balls, two strikes. Pitch from Vail comes in. That one off the mark. Will be ball one. 1-2. Dylan Vail looking to get out of this inning. Pitches in. That one inside for ball two. 2-2 count. Lefty on righty. That one is rolled over. Will it get through the gap? And it's not picked up cleanly. Martinez scores. He reaches home. Now runners on the corners as, again, the Weevils unable to scoop it off the infield dirt. And now Chase Hudson to the plate.
Perfect setup. Just a miss, an error over there. You know, that's exactly the kind of breaks that SNU is just going to take and then capitalize on. That's what we love to see.
Boy, it's 8-3 Storm. And now 1-0 count against Hudson. Dylan Vail, where he's in a heater to make it 2-0s. It was off the mark. Two balls, no strikes. Couple outs as well. Breaking ball, look good.
Wow.
2-1.
SNU dugout getting lively.
They are.
We love to hear that.
The 2-1 is low. Now 3-1. Hudson, three balls, one strike against Vail. Vail on the way, off the mark, ball four. Did he go? He did not. That was a late appeal, but they'll give it to him.
Yeah. Catcher wanted it. Umpire didn't want to check. He knew.
So now, with bases loaded, Weston Hicks at the plate. And Diaz, who had the leadoff single, is on deck. A meeting on the bump. Now, here's the thing about the way Dylan Vail is performing right now. He did not get to warm up like he normally would get to. That's part of what's going on.
Yeah, it's super unfortunate. Didn't even really have a full inning to get those pitches thrown in the bullpen. Just got to stretch out a little bit and then immediately tossed in a very tough situation for him.
And honestly, it's not that his pitching has been the problem. It's been errors in the field.
Yeah, the second and third baseman not being able to field two balls is hurting the Weevils. And SNU, like Roach said, ready to capitalize on it. And, man, this has just got to feel good when you look at that scoreboard out there, seeing nine hits.
So Weston Hicks at the plate, base is loaded. First pitch of the at-bat will bounce for ball one. One oh count.
Potential to really put some nails in the coffin here for SNU, so we'll see what plays out.
Now the 1-0 from Vail. On the way is outside. Ball two. Looks like UAM will send a couple guys to their bullpen. Now the 2-0. Brought in. That looked good. It was strike one. That one slid. Two one. Vail on the way. Off again. Three balls, one strike.
Great take there by Wes.
Top swing, that'll make it a full count.
He wanted every piece of that ball.
He did. Now, if you're Dylan Vail, if you get out of this situation, you may see your return next inning as Jacob McDaniel is warming up in the bullpen. Payoff pitch on the way. Check swing, did he go?
Wow.
They'll say he did. The appeal works against Hicks.
Another very late appeal, though.
Very, very late, but they'll give him the strikeout swinging. Good enough for out number three, and that hurts bad for a couple of reasons. The main one being if you somehow keep things going as the storm, you had the runners on base to put this in a run rule contention.
Really? You just sent me into shock. Wow. You're so right, though.
I am. I'm rarely wrong.
Oh, sure.
I'm just kidding. I'm wrong all the time, actually.
I was going to say, as your boss, I don't know if that statement is factual.
You are tech. Am I your boss right now, though?
You are. I think you are.
Look at you
the
guys.
The duality of man.
The duality. The tables have turned.
Here's what's interesting to me. I do think we'll see Dylan Vail return next inning. But warming up is Jacob McDaniel, and he's got that sidearm almost into a submarine action, sitting 6'195", and he's a senior out of Roxy, Mississippi, coming in from Southwest Mississippi Community College. So that's a tough guy to face. Even if he's not always a consistently great pitcher, just the way that you've been facing pitchers that have been very over the top and just textbook guys, facing a guy like that is going to be tough, especially as he is, just in general, a really good pitcher with a 2.19 ERA. But we'll get more into that later as Zach Robinson is on the mound for the Crimson Storm. He's going to come in and face Tanner, Romero, and Wolf. Camden Tanner batting lefty. Robinson. First pitch on the ground, over to second. Scooped up, Edmonds gets it to first. Out number one.
You love to see that first pitch swing straight into the ground. Routine play. Already put one on the board.
Yeah, it's, honestly, results-wise, you don't love to see that as UAM, but you do love to see early aggression here in the later stage of this ball game too. It didn't go your way that time, but both sides, I think, happy with how that went.
Absolutely.
Obviously, SNU a little more happy, but it's a mindset thing.
Yeah,
it's a mindset thing.
Again, making a contact with the ball, especially coming off that last inning, I think that's big for UAM.
First pitch of this at-bat, called strike one. This is Parker Dorrance stepping in for Romero. Now 1-1. Dorrance, about 6'3" as well. We've seen a couple tall batters on Monticello's roster. Now 2-1 count. He's hitting 267 this season. He's getting up 16 hits so far this year. The 2-1. Robinson brings it in high for ball three. Monticello hasn't scored since the second inning. The first two made it look like the Weevils were going to be in control through the duration. But since then.
Yeah, Gabriel Sanchez coming in that third inning, really just doing it for SNU, doing exactly what you needed him to do, and held him to zero runs throughout.
Yeah. Levi Graham gave you the start you were looking for, then Sanchez came out and outperformed what you really thought he was going to do.
Absolutely.
Now Robinson with a man on first, facing Kirk Wolf. First pitch off the mark.
Yeah, and I mean, Robinson coming in last inning with bases loaded.
Well, he walked to load the bases.
Sure. Got the bases.
But no, the point stands, but, yeah, though.
Getting out of that with zero runs, good for him.
We're going to meeting here with two balls, no strikes. A little talk with Zach Robinson, maybe ease a little of the tension here. Here's the question. You're comfortable with Zach Robinson, but you did bring him in a little early. It's now the top of the seventh. Who do you look to next if he doesn't take you the distance?
Dare I say, Tyler Reed?
I knew you were going to say Tyler Reed. Now, I'm not opposed to that. Don't get me wrong. I'm not. Here's the thing, though. That is a dangerous move.
Just a little bit. Hey, if anybody can handle pressure, though, it's our man, Tyler Reed.
Two balls, no strikes. Kirk Wolf at the plate. Dorrance on first. The 2-0 from Robinson. There's strike one. And out of the meeting, that first pitch is always big. You get the strike you were looking for there. Now 2-1. Pitch on the inside edge for ball three. Three balls, one strike, a single out on the board, runner on first. Getting back in this one would be big. Robinson brings it in. That one hit high in foul territory. It's straight back. I think Roach is gone.
Yeah, I think Roach decided to get
preoccupied.
Oh, hey,
we're getting deep into the political side of Twitter.
Oh, no.
You know, it's kind of scary, but, you know.
Roach, you know what's better than that? SNU baseball right now.
Yeah. Hey, come on.
Hey, full count, payoff pitch coming up. Robinson out of the stretch with a runner on first, one out on the board. This is a big at-bat for both sides. Payoff pitch on the way. Foul tip straight back.
Would have come right through this window.
Yeah, Roach was ready for it, too. Yeah. I saw him. He reached out, tried to get it. Hey, what's interesting with Robinson on the mound is the way he pitches. It's very nitpicky for umpires. He's trying to work not even always outside, just the left side.
Yeah.
Well, I guess our left, his right. Payoff. Again. Ooh, just off. Just off. That'll be ball four.
Man, honestly, good at bat for UAM. Really fought.
Yeah.
Got the pitch count up a little bit and still managed to get on base.
Wolf did exactly what they needed him to do there, as Kinsia comes to the plate. Still one out. Runners on first and second. Could theoretically get out with a double play here. That would be huge. First pitch, ball one. The 1-0. On the way, breaking ball. They won't give it to him. 2-0.
High.
Looks like that may be Landon Kinder warming up for SMU. Out in the bullpen. 2-0. Whew, good pitch. Strike one.
I like that from SMU bullpen or dugout saying, hey, we're not here. We're not bailing them out. They've got to earn this. They got to earn the comeback.
Yeah.
Keep fighting.
Two balls, one strike. Robinson deals. That one going to be swung on and fouled off the right side. Hey, do you remember when PETA said to call it the arm barn?
I do. Guess what?
Huh.
We didn't call it the arm barn.
We didn't. That's true. Mm-hmm. Now the 2-2. Robinson, again, fouled off to the right side. He's getting back in the zone. That's a big development here for Zach Robinson.
Yeah, he needed that. He needed to find it. Got first couple pitches just not finding where he needs to be.
Boy, how big would a strikeout be here? The 2-2. Hit high. This one going to float out of play to the right side. Oh, my goodness, that really floated. Initially off the bat, you felt like that one could have been played, but it just
didn't
shot
quite
right.
Hear a truck getting hit, so I think we're in the clear on that ball.
Now the 2-2 again. Robinson from the stretch. Lefty on righty brings it in. That one again fouled off to the right.
I mean, what an at bat here.
Yeah, and Kinsia is going oppo with every single one of these, too.
Yeah.
2-2. Robinson delivers. That one swung on the ground towards third this time. Brinkmeyer picks it up in foul territory. An absolute battle of an at-bat here from Cade. Robinson again. Two balls, two strikes from the stretch. Loads, delivers. That one off the mark. Sooner or later, he was going to miss one. That one got away.
Yeah, luckily, he had one to give there.
Yeah. 3-2. Full count. Payoff pitch from Robinson. Brought in. That one swung on. This one in play. It's high towards right field. Dias getting under it. Max Dias makes the grab, and the runner's going to hold as Dias. We've talked about this so often. One of the strongest arms of any outfield in the Great American Conference. There he proved it with an absolute rope to third base, which holds Dorrance on second.
Yeah, smart base running there after just a routine fly ball to right field. Shouldn't have probably advanced runners, but
yeah,
you're not running on his arm.
Now Garrett to the plate. Aiden Garrett, the shortstop. His last time up, he got walked. First pitch to him, called ball one. Here's the thing, too. You felt like you were about to get in some trouble as Zach Robinson. Now two outs. This feels much more manageable than where you were.
Two outs, force on bags 1-3. I mean, yeah, you got to feel good if you're Zach and how you've recovered from this inning.
Now 2-0.
Fighting the ump here, it looks like.
Well, I hope not.
Hey, that makes good TV.
That would make good TV. 2-0. Robinson, with some help from the flyover, will get strike one. That's a large plane. That is a larger plane than we're used to.
It's got to put commercial some amp in your veins.
Come on.
Unfortunately, our camera operator didn't get it.
Oh, that's me.
Oh, yeah. 2-1. Now 2-2. Good pitch from Robinson. Here in the top of the seventh, you're leading by five. Twos are hot on the board. Runners on first and second. Zach Robinson wants to get out of this inning. Boy, there's a giant plane somewhere nearby.
Sounds like an ICBM inbound.
Again, I sure hope not. Full count. Two outs, runners on first and second. Garrett at the plate, Robinson facing down. Payoff pitch. Got him!
Boom.
Looking! Zach Robinson! Oh,
keeping
my goodness.
The weevils at bay and shutting them down, keeping that five-run lead.
8-3 as we get ready for the bottom of the seventh here in game one of the three-game series, Southern Nazarene. Oh, my goodness. Zach Robinson. Oh, my goodness. We'll take a break, step away, and be right back after this. You're watching SNU Baseball on the Call Sports Network. Welcome you back into the booth once again. SNU leading this one by five here in the bottom of the seventh. Dylan Vail will make a return out to the mound for UAM.
I don't know if it's a C4 energy or Zach Robinson getting out of that inning, but
Robinson.
I am amped
Robinson
for the rest of this game.
Yeah, they're all the same.
You said Robertson.
Rob
silly goose. Please. First pitch swung on, just foul.
Oh,
Max Dias,
man,
almost had the most beautiful possible shot to get out of the infield, but it just goes foul down the third base line.
That is a
Did
shame.
Did you get that one?
I got the flyover.
That's
Come
what
on.
I like. That's what I like.
If we have Roach out there umping, he calls that fair because he can't see the ball.
That's true.
That's a good point. Good point. Dias again, foul to the left side. Oh, 2 count against Dias. Dylan Vail.
Got a warning.
That one off the mark. Try to get him reaching. Max Dias wasn't even almost tempted by that one. Last time up for Dias was in the last inning in which he hit the leadoff single. That ball is low for ball two. Two balls, two strikes. First at bat in the bottom of the seventh. Dias will foul that to the right side.
Looks like it's going to Zeus.
I feel like you're one of those like Elmo toys that he has like three things he says.
Hey, man.
He's a soundboard.
That's high praise.
2-2. On the way, Dias will see strike three. He knew it. That was a good pitch. So Max Dias sat down. He's going to bring up Tucker LeMay.
What almost got me there was the struggle with their infield celebration there, almost fumbling the ball around. But, you know, I'll give it to him.
What are you giving to him?
He made an effort out there.
Jeez.
Tucker LeMay, albeit the first time at bat was a strange occurrence, but has really just been on base all game, it feels like.
Yeah. LeMay has reached home twice, by the way.
Wow.
Not going to lie, as soon as that made contact, immediately out of my vision. Just blur. Couldn't see it. Isn't that amazing?
So amazing. The 1-1 on the way. LeMay will foul tip that.
That was a juicy pitch right down the middle, and LeMay watered it.
He did. One of those where your eyes get a little too wide.
Happens a lot when I'm playing the show.
Happens a lot when I go get ice cream. I get a little too much.
Oh,
1-2.
Sure.
Pitch on the way. Hey, watches it go by. I will go low for ball two.
I'd like to take a moment to apologize to all the listeners at home for my less than colorful commentary. But thanks for sticking with us this long.
That's why we got three.
2-2, swing and a miss, strike three. Another big pitch that time from Dylan Vail. Two strikeouts, back to back, one looking, one swinging. Now Colby Entwistle from the top of the lineup will come in with two outs and no one on.
Very different inning from Dylan. And I think, like you said, he didn't get enough warm-up that last inning, so coming in just having just stretched. Now he's able to go out there and throw some pitches and get his boots under him. Cleats, in this case.
There you go. 0-1. Oh, heavy hack, strike two. Hmm. Out in front of it. Did you ever see secondhand Lions going out with your boots on?
I did not.
Oh, that's a shame. You need to see it. 0-2. Pitch on the way, Entwistle chopped at
great
it, and he
contact.
Got it down in left field. Boy, that was a swing he almost felt bad for throwing out there. He slowed it down to catch up to the ball, and he got it into left field. So another single. This time it's Entwistle.
Keeping the storm alive in this inning with two outs on the board.
And Dax Edmonds to the plate. We talked about two-out hitting earlier in this game. Man, another example of it right there.
It's the storm specialty, really. That is
sure.
What we are known for this season.
The 1-0. Swung on Edmonds towards right field. That's in foul territory. Wait, it would have been close if it stayed fair. I think it might have been gone. Especially if Roach was calling it. I actually have – oh, man, I need to tell you guys something. 1-1 on the way. This summer, as Austin knows, I was in Cape Cod with the Cape Cod Baseball League.
Sure.
I watched a ground rule double actually get called a home run because they didn't see it. Actually, as a mistake, was called a home run, and it stood. The 2-1.
See, and that just goes to show there are worse people out there at this than I, and that makes me feel good.
Sure, yeah, hey,
if that's
what you get out of that, then you know what, it's all right. Entwistle advances to second. 3-1. Pitch on the way. That'll be ball four. Hey, we'll take it.
I'd like to take a moment to just clarify, I am not compensated for what I am doing here today. This is strictly voluntary.
It is, I'll give you that.
So...
Cheap,
don't expect much.
Oh, okay.
So two outs, runners on first and second. Jacob Martinez to the plate. We'll watch strike one. He comes up batting lefty against the right-handed arm of Dylan Vail.
He did not like that call.
Martinez is a pretty vocal guy. 0-1. Now 1-1.
My favorite thing that Martinez does at bat is if it is a ball or a ball that he does not want, he will sit there and shake his head no at the ball.
The 1-1.
Hey.
There you go.
Zoom
you
in
go.
On it, Sean. Zoom in.
I like a guy who knows what he wants and what he doesn't like.
The 2-1. Two balls, one strike. Pitch on the way. Off the mark.
Didn't really do it that time. Yeah.
He gave it a little bit, but he turned away. And
I do sometimes forget I am on the camera.
You are on the camera.
He's the guy on the camera.
Three balls, one strike. Again, runners on first and second, two outs. And Trey Orman on deck. Pitch on the way, heavy swing for strike two.
There was actually a secret fourth man on the camera. We do not know who it is. Could be anybody.
Full count. Payoff pitch on the way. Martinez swing and a miss. Strike three. So that will end the inning for the Weevils. Three strikeouts that time for Dylan Vail. A very big difference from his last inning, in which he had to face nine batters. So next time up for SNU will be Orman, Brinkmeyer, and Hudson. But on the other side of things, we get ready for Cripps, Owens, and Hawthorne. We'll take a break, step away, and get ready for the eighth inning. You're watching SNU Baseball on the Call Sports Network.
Visit renew.snu.edu or email renew@renew is the University Counseling Center. We are located at 6710 Northwest 43rd Street, just north of the Webster Commons. Renew offers a variety of services, including individual counseling, couples counseling, and psychoeducational workshops. The first five sessions for students are free, and students will never pay more than $10 per session. Faculty counseling is just $40 per session. Renew is open Monday through Thursday from 9 a.m. to 8 p.m. and Fridays from 11 a.m. until 6 p.m. For more information, visit renew.snu.edu or email renew@mail.snu.edu.
And we welcome you back. Zach Robinson remains on the bump for Southern Nazarene. He's getting ready to face Cripps, Owens, and Hawthorne. Man, we're in the eighth inning, guys, already. This game seems like it's flown by, and it hasn't really actually been quick, but it's just been a lot of fun.
Yeah, speaking of the eighth inning, I think you are very happy with Zach Robinson here and being able to start the eighth inning. See what he does right here.
Robinson with 36 pitches to this point comes in. First pitch, strike one. If you're Southern Nazarene, do you warm up a closer?
Yes.
I think Landon Kinder was out there earlier. He's sat down since. Still in the bullpen, but he sat down. Now an 0-2 count here against Cripps.
And you maybe get a little ambitious and say, hey, actually, we're just going to try to mercy rule them.
Run rule.
Is there a difference?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. But I don't think that's really on your mind right now if you're SNU. In all honesty, I don't think it is. And I don't think it should be either.
No, it shouldn't be. Especially when hits
that
like
ball
that.
Is hit hard to the right side. It's going to go foul. Unfortunately, our camera didn't catch that one either.
I'll let him know to fix it next time.
Woo!
Hey, I'm working on it.
1-2. Cripps at the plate. Chase. Batting righty, the 1-2 on the way. It's outside for ball two. It is nice, though, being able to zoom in the camera a little bit and still catch action.
Sure.
It's much
it's
nicer than usual.
Every, like, five pitches, I'll move it.
Two balls, two strikes. Pitch on the way, just high for ball three. Full count now for Chase Cripps. Now Robinson. On the stretch, payoff. Just off. Boy, he thought he got it on the outer edge.
Yeah.
We'll give him ball four.
I thought so too.
So Cripps, Cripps walks to first and Owens to the plate. Runner on first. Robinson brings it in. That one high and inside, 1-0.
To answer your earlier question of do you warm up a closer, I do think the answer is yes. Another flyover that I missed.
It's all right. It's all right. You don't have to get all of them. But you got one. That's the important thing.
Sure.
The 1-0.
One out of six.
That one swung on, hit hard towards center field. Martinez tracking. Martinez diving grab. Martinez got it.
Did he? No. They're saying he didn't.
No, he did. They're saying on the transition he dropped it, so he gets the out.
Okay.
Da-da-da, da-da-da. For out number one.
Understood that reference.
Hey, you know who else got it? The cameraman.
Yeah, he did.
Come on.
High five.
That was good.
It was good.
They did, in fact, high five. If you couldn't hear it,
it was a good high five.
I'm a third witness. Let's do the high five.
Oh, man. One out on the board. Hawthorne at the plate. First pitch will be thrown to first. Check the runner. Here's what you like to see. Carson Kennard in the bullpen. Just a little pep talk.
What a leader.
Great leader. Robinson's pitch inside. Now 1-0. Cripps on first. Pitches in. That one off as well. Two balls now. Cripps not getting much of a lead. Oh, Monticello. Trying to play pretty straight up here. 2-0. Pitch on the way. Robinson brings it in. Swung on. Hit towards the left side. In foul territory. Brinkmeyer tracking. It's going to go out of play. Would have been a tough grab if it stayed close. But it didn't stay close. It was not even almost catchable. Unless it was like, you know, the Wimby dunk?
Oh, yes.
Or Space Jam?
What's the...
Either or. Yeah. Either or.
Not familiar.
Oh, man. 2-1. 2-1. Robinson. Deal. Swung on hard towards center field. Martinez underneath it. Martinez makes the grab. Two outs. Jacob Martinez sends Hawthorne back to the dugout. Now Chaz Poppy to the plate.
Good pop fly, keeping the runner on first. Two outs left in this inning. One out left.
Robinson, first pitch. That had a little wiggle for strike one. Now the 0-1. And runner remains on first. Still not getting much of a lead. 0-1 right back to Robinson. Easy snag for him, a reactionary grab at the mound. And he'll walk off like it was nothing.
Checking the glove.
How about poise right there? Didn't even bother him. We're headed to the bottom of the eighth. Southern Nazarene leading the Weevils by 5. Fellas, how you feeling?
That is a phenomenal way to get out of that inning. And again, like you mentioned earlier, the Weevils don't have a run on the board since the second inning. That's massive. Yeah. For
huge.
SMU.
Yeah. Huge. And the question here becomes, actually, I don't even think it's a question. Kinder not even pretending to warm up over in the bullpen. He's laid out. He's completely laid out. That's hilarious.
He's tanning.
He is tanning in pants and a sleeve.
His wrist.
He's let his wrist tan.
Grant, let me ask you this.
Anti-Apple Watch tan.
You're SNU.
Yes, I am.
You're facing a new pitcher here.
Okay.
Like you mentioned earlier, a different pitching style.
Very different.
What, if you're Ledbetter, what are you saying to the guys going into this?
Swing away.
Swing away. I
I'm
like
saying
that.
Swing away. Hey. Force him to be better than you. That's what I'm saying right here as you get ready to face Jacob McDaniel. And Roach, what was that? He just thumbs down the roster of Arkansas Monticello. I've never seen that before.
Let him know.
He did let him know.
It bolts up, baby.
But here's the thing. You're facing a very good pitcher. That's the thing. It's not just that he throws sidearm. It's that he throws sidearm well.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
You're coming in. You've got to come in aggressive. I don't think you can be passive because he's not going to miss.
You know,
at least not miss a lot.
It's not uncommon to see a game absolutely get flipped on its head and then the opposing team that was down just take runs and slap them on the board. But, you know, with SNU in the position that they are, I mean, they're feeling strong, and I say go for it. They know what they're doing today. And they're showing it, so, yeah, I'd give them the green light and say go ahead and slap them on down.
Speaking of the green light, I'm giving Trey Orman here the biggest green light you've ever seen.
This is, honestly, We talked about times before where you wanted Trey Orman to really hit something hard. But if you bring in a new pitcher and Orman, first inning of him being in, does something with a ball, man, that's demoralizing.
Absolutely.
0-1, though, like we said, tough action here. The sidearm, you never know when it's going to drop. 0-1. You either love him or you hate him, right? Orman wanted that one. He can't get it. Strike two.
Little fun fact about Trey Orman. Me and him are from the same area.
The entire state of Texas.
The entire Keller, Texas, baby.
Roach just choked on his drink. 0-2. Pitch on the way. Orman hits that one high to right field. Trey Orman in foul territory. Boy, it might have been gone by a mile. That ball might have been gone by a mile.
Right, and honestly,
again, the wind blowing
a little bit
direction.
Of wind could have made it better if it was going the other way.
He raked that.
No wind there would have probably kept that one fair and gone. The 0-2 to Orman. Inside for ball one. And what's crazy is it didn't even seem like a heavy swing. It was just
that was just perfect contact.
It was
right
a
there.
Common man.
He's
1-2.
Built for power.
He is. 1-2 from McDaniel. Brought in outside. 2-2. And we talked about this before, too. Orman, he's a great hitter, not just because he swings hard, but because he knows what not to swing at. That's the difference between good and great. It's pitch discipline.
Absolutely. His vision is something to watch as you go throughout this rest of the season.
Orman on the ground towards third. Easy pickup this time, and the throw is right where it needs to be. Romero makes the play for out number one. Well, you get contact on him. That's what's important there. You don't get the result you wanted as it almost was a home run, but you do force the ball into play. Now Blake Brinkmeyer.
Third baseman scooting up on him a little bit. Seen this before. Didn't work out for that.
That's a good point. It didn't. So one out, 1-0 count, no one on for Brinkmeyer. The 1-0. Swung on. This one on the ground towards second. Play should be made, and it is. Two batters, two ground outs. Now Chase Hudson to the plate.
Two batters, though, both getting contact on a new pitcher.
Yeah.
Again, like you said, come out and attack him. Come out swinging.
And that's a sign of a dangerous offensive team, which is what we were really hoping for this season. And boy, if you play like this every game.
We'll say we're getting it right now.
1-0 count. McDaniel. He'll bring it in. Just off the mark. Man, 2-0. Chase Hudson batting lefty. Now the 2-0 on the way. Hudson, same spot as Brinkmeyer. The ball will be picked up cleanly by Cripps. And Cripps gets it to Cancia for out number three. So we're headed to the final inning of play. And wouldn't you know it, SNU leads by 5. Against Arkansas Monticello, who is 11-4 in conference play this season. No experts.
Go ahead and make it 11-5.
Oh. That's a crazy thing to say.
Have come out to play today, here's, and I think they're shutting them down. Thinking simple ass.
Well, that's your second prediction of the day. Your first one was one of the most horrible guesses I've ever heard.
Oh, my goodness.
So here's what I'm thinking, guys. Monticello by no means is out.
No.
By no means is dead.
Nah.
Okay. Okay. Camden Tanner, the third batter in the lineup, will come up. And yeah, they're in the meat of the lineup, but also if they're gonna come back into this one, they're gonna have to bat pretty much all the way through.
Yep.
Here's what makes me nervous. I have a lot of faith and a lot of trust in Zach Robinson.
Yes.
Here's what makes me nervous. He's been in there a few innings. And what also makes me nervous is Landon Kinder. Man, he wasn't warming up. Now, he did get in there a few innings ago. He is throwing now.
He got his tan on. He was waiting for the tan.
He's waiting for the tan. It feels good outside.
Sure.
Man, there are a lot of just mixed feelings for me right now. I feel good that everyone's relaxed. I feel good that everyone feels comfortable. Just nervous.
I feel it.
This game means a lot.
It does.
This game means a lot. That's the bottom line here.
He can sit out there all day. UV is at 2. I mean, there's just plenty of time. Things are looking up.
What is Roach talking about?
I don't know, but Zach just threw an incredible first pitch for this.
Yes, he did. The 0-1. Robinson setting the tone as
that
one's going
to
be fouled.
That one belongs to Zeus, and it's in truck territory.
It might belong to your truck.
Double trouble.
We just hit two buttons on the Riley Smith soundboard. 0-2.
There's only like 3, so.
Yeah. One of them is just terrible guess. The 0-2 on the way, well off.
No, I'm right there with you, Grant. I have faith in Zach, and he's come out strong this inning. But
yes.
He's got a wheel and deal in this final, and UAM, they want it. They're not going out without a fight.
And
there's going to be another foul ball.
Back-to-back destruction of the truck.
The crowd is worried.
Very worried. Oh, man. 1-2 count. No outs on the board. Here for Camden Tanner. Tanner gets a hold of that one towards left field. It's going to drop high. Boy, it's still in the air, and it's going to get down. Tucker LeMay from shortstop was tracking it down. Looked like LeMay might have called off Hudson and Brinkmeyer. That probably was Brinkmeyer's ball to get to. So it'll be a leadoff double.
I don't know if that ball had a lot of movement in the sky where Tucker thought it was dropping at him, but caught a little wind and dropped right behind third place.
The initial read was, let Tucker LeMay get it, but after a little bit, it was out of his range. Now Dorrance at the plate. He'll take ball one. What's so unfortunate, too, is you felt like you had your first out there as Robinson did exactly what you needed him to do.
It
makes you nervous. We've seen things like that turn into better for the other side as there's strike one with the wave. Roach is unbothered.
He hasn't been bothered all 9 innings.
My favorite thing is that Roach rarely talks. He just gives noises, and you have to interpret. 1-1. What is it? Is it the Roy Kent in Ted Lasso? That's what he does. He just makes noises.
It does. Good. Good reference.
Dude, I'm on fire today with my references. 2-1.
I didn't get that one. I don't have Apple TV.
2-1. I don't either.
What? How are you watching the show?
It was a while ago. It's old, dude.
Roach,
it's old.
Show.
It's like a 3-season show. 3-1.
Watching a good show.
Robinson against Dorrance.
Not going to watch.
The 3-1 on the way. Robinson deals. That's going to be tipped back. Now a full count.
How are you going to know?
Are you still talking about Ted Lasso?
How are you going to know if you don't watch the show? Does that make sense?
I have watched the show. What is
so you had Apple TV?
No. Full count. Payoff pitch on the way. Did he go? He did not. They'll give him ball 4. Boy, tough at bat there. Now you do have a force in all bags, and you can give up 4 runs.
That is true.
That's nothing to keep in mind.
Let's not go there.
Let's not go there, sure. But
why not? Give him 3 on the board right now.
There's a – no.
I – have been impressed, though. Zach has come into this inning.
Oh, yeah.
And done his job, really.
Wolf at the plate.
These at-bats are not easy.
Well, keep in mind, Robinson also came in mid-inning.
That's true.
Came into a tough situation. He's up 59 pitches now. On a 1-0. Whew. That'll make it 2-0. Monticello still feeling good about their chances here.
Could be our angle. I don't know. That pitch looked like a strike to me. I'm not an umpire.
It looked low to me.
That's why you do this for a living.
Yeah. I don't, actually. 2-0. There it is.
There we
one.
Go. Strong strike.
Two balls, one strike. Runners on first and second. Still no outs. Here on the top of the ninth. Robinson loads, deals. Swung on, foul ball right side.
And that one's going up to Mount Olympus itself.
He switched it up on man.
Grant. Yeah. He did. He you did. I wasn't I was ready.
Like, come on.
Come on. Good reference. He did read the books. 2-2. Robinson could get one here. Zach. Sends it in. That one hit high towards left field. This one, catchable. Hudson chasing. Now LeMay gets to it in foul
there
territory. Tucker LeMay.
Good work, cameraman, for picking that one up.
Man, that's a big out right there. Big out. You need two more if you're the Storm to take game one by five. 10 hits on the board for the Crimson Storm. 6 for UAM. Can't see ya at the plate. And see ya. He's going to get it down in left field. This is going to score one, it looks like. No, that'll hold him up.
Wow.
Probably wise as the throw from Hudson. Had quite the velo on it. Good move from him. So bases now juiced. And
Tyler
Garrett
signaling.
To the plate.
Yep, some great deliberation and discipline on keeping him on third.
Tyler Broyles, your pitching coach, signaling that we're ready. He's warmed up, ready to come in.
Yeah.
I think they're going to keep Robinson in a little longer as Ledbetter is going to walk out to the bullpen, have a conversation. And like we said before, it's not – this is a bad situation, sure, but it's not a terrible spot to be. You got an out on the board, bases loaded, double play in effect, and you're leading by five. So still, the tying runner not in play.
And also not SDU's first time to have the bases loaded on them, and yet UAM hasn't been able to put a run on the board since the second.
Spirit in the sky hitting the sound waves. Clearly a reference to Zeus. Clearly.
Sure.
Oh, man. Garrett at the plate. Aiden hoping to get just a base hit here. That would be huge for UAM as there's strike one. This ball's hit on the ground. Weevils might be in trouble. The 0-1. Swung on. Garrett, foul ball left side.
Told y'all.
You gotta have this guy on the mic board. He's awesome.
I don't know about that. The 0-2. 0-2. It's entertaining. Having a good time. Two on the way. Swung on. Foul ball left side. It's a line drive.
Heads up, horses.
That makes you a little nervous. I don't know, full of nerves. This is such a big game. Such a big game for SNU. If you can pull this off.
Two strikes, big swings coming out.
Robinson, the 0-2 on the way, just off the mark. David Lowe, 1-2. Aiden Garrett, one ball, two strikes, and out on the board. Base is loaded. Robinson, deals, swung on the ground to Zach. He's going to send it home. The out at home is there. No one scores. Bases remain loaded, and you've got one more out.
Great at bat for Zach.
Absolutely.
good decision there. Throw it home, beat the runner, stop the run coming in, hold them to three.
Two outs, Chase Cripps to bat. Robinson, first pitch is high. Chase Cripps, his last time up, got walked. He has yet to get a hit today. He's walked twice. And grounded out to third. There's a rocket to left field. This could be it. This could be it. Ball game. Chase Hudson seals it in left field. And Southern Nazarene wins game one of the series 8-3 against the Weevils of Arkansas Monticello. The trip up from the natural state has been a salty one thus far as game one drops for the 11-4 in conference, now 11-5 Weevils and Southern Nazarene. Oh my goodness. That Southern Arkansas game might have changed something.
That's what Come I'm on.
Saying. Just I as think, predicted, honestly.
Sure. Grant, you're Ledbetter right now. You've taken one off SAU. You just took your first game off UAM, headed into two more tomorrow. Yeah. And again, like we talked about, the pitching starting us off. That's not your best pitching lineup. What are you telling the guys coming in tomorrow?
I'm saying, hey, this is the new standard. This is the standard. It is. Not saying that you're going to win against Arkansas Monticello every game. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying the intensity and the intentionality of every single play today was perfect. Zero errors on the board, 10 hits. This is the SNU team that they thought they were going to be early on in the year. Now you see it. Now you felt it. Now you know that you are capable against quality opponents to be a quality opponent yourself. And that is huge in and of itself for so many reasons.
Absolutely. 10 hits in this game. A lot of them coming in those first couple innings with UAM's one of their best pitchers on the mound. I think you have a lot of confidence coming in tomorrow doing the same thing.
Probably you might see Will Desotel start tomorrow. Gunnar Phillips could be out there. Here's what's awesome. Here's what's crazy to me about the game we just saw. Arkansas Monticello had bases loaded a couple of times.
Yeah.
And couldn't convert on any of them. They didn't score since the second inning. One in the first, two in the second. They were up 3-0 heading into the third. And it felt like they were well in control. It felt like they were ready to keep things going. And the wheels fell off.
Absolutely. And some, again, we've talked a lot about it, but some great pitching coming in from SNU. Only being able to use three pitchers, too. Huge. Absolutely huge. When you look at it, too, you got Zach, who came in half an inning, came in half an inning and got out of a tight, tight inning a couple times. We just saw it again. Bases loaded. Zach steps up, pulls it out, and making SNU only have to use three pitchers. Being able to save a big pitching lineup coming into a doubleheader tomorrow is huge. And just such a big momentum shift for SNU.
Yeah, and like you said earlier, talking about the kind of caliber team that we expected to see earlier on the season, I mean, if you just look at the, you know, you talked about the lack of errors on SNU's side. You talked about, you know, the runs just being converted from the hits percentage-wise. I mean, they just looked like a great team out there today. And so, yeah, setting the standard and making sure we take every measure possible to just keep this going.
8-3, the final score here at Phelan Field. Southern Nazarene takes game one of the three-game series. Maybe some shockwaves sent into the GAC with this one. The big one is tomorrow, though. The big day is tomorrow. Now, you set yourself up in a big way, but you've got to expect UAM to come out tomorrow. I think bats flying.
Yeah, I think UAM is kind of fired up a little bit. Not taking the series or not taking the win today and trying to look and see if they can take the series tomorrow. But if you're SNU, getting one tomorrow is huge.
Yeah.
I mean, and that, again, we've talked a lot about it, but that just changes the rest of your season. You've got 20 games left, and I think, again, after SAU, you're like, man, we can do this. After today, it's
we're doing this.
Yeah, and I think you keep that momentum and you keep that mindset for the rest of the 20 games, you're looking at a decent season.
Yeah.
You might. Yeah. No, go ahead. Go
I
ahead.
Would just say, you know, keeping their head on a swivel whenever it came down to pressure situations. You know, bases loaded multiple times, but, you know, just staying dialed in and, you know, grounded on what's going on right in front of them. They just didn't let the pressure get to them, and I think that's just one great and important thing to be highlighted about the Storm today.
It was error – don't want to say error heavy, but a few costly mistakes – from Monticello really seemed to seal the deal today. And maybe a couple mistakes from SNU that could have been very costly, but they recover nicely. So tomorrow is going to be the big day, though. It starts at noon. We'll be live probably 11:45-ish. So be there for that. Man, big day, big day. We're excited to see you tomorrow. It's a pleasure to have you along today. Thank you for watching. Thank you for listening. I'm Grant McNew. That's Austin Schoenfeldt. That's Riley the Roach Smith. We'll be back tomorrow. It's been a pleasure.